It's a football Saturday afternoon in Charlottesville, Virginia. And number 9 Notre Dame's visit is a first ever. The Irish are led by Malik Zaire, a lefty who proved last week he is much more than just a running quarterback. Meanwhile, Cavalier quarterback Matt Johns looks to ignite a Virginia offense that struggled at times last week at UCLA. Rain is in the forecast, but a sellout crowd at Scott Stadium is ready for anything. Welcome to the ACC on ESPN. We are in Charlottesville as Virginia plays host to a Notre Dame team about to play its first football game in school history in the Commonwealth of Virginia. Good afternoon, everybody. Mike Patrick, Ed Cunningham. It's great to have you with us. Dr. Jerry Punch will join us shortly. It's difficult to draw a whole lot of conclusions after only one game, but for Notre Dame, what a one game it was. They destroyed Texas.
It's nice. The whole country's watching you in the era of the college football playoff because of the name brand of Texas. It was dominating. Texas got a long way to go to get back to elite. But we saw Notre Dame in 2012 at the end of the season, the year they went to play for the national championship against Alabama. This team's way better than that team. It's much better. And Brian Kelly knows it. They have more depth. And they have an offensive and defensive line, unlike what they had in 2012. They can dominate up front. Now, this is a playoff-caliber team for sure.
Brian Kelly also told us that if his quarterback Malik Zaire plays anywhere near the way he did against Texas, this could be a pretty good offense.
Well, it helps when you have Will Fuller, a guy who had 15 touchdown catches last year, tied the school record. The safeties for Texas were out of position all evening, and Zaire and Fuller made them pay time and time again. The one thing that Malik did during the offseason, worked extremely hard on his footwork. It's more on balance. He's got a shorter stride. Here, a very accurate throw to a once again wide-open Fuller. Not sure that Fuller will be this open today against Virginia, but this is a guy who's probably the quietest superstar in college football. He's a Notre Dame wide receiver, keeps playing like he's playing. He'll get into the conversation for the Heisman race.
One of the problems for Virginia in the Mike London era has been lack of stability at quarterback. This year, it's do or die with one guy. That's all they've got.
And coming out of spring ball, they decided that Matt Johns was going to be the starter. Grayson Lambert and Johns had traded off last year. Lambert then decides he's going to transfer. He's now the starter at Georgia. So Matt Johns becomes the guy. There are no quarterbacks behind him now with any real college experience. Last year, it went back and forth between Johns and Lambert. And Johns came into spring ball, and he took over the job. They clearly said he was first string. So you go into the first game against a very good UCLA pass rush, and Johns held together pretty well.
When we come back, our Dr. Jerry Punch will talk with Notre Dame head coach Brian Kelly. Welcome back to Charlottesville, Virginia, as the fans continue to pour into Scott Stadium. We expect to sell out. The weather forecast actually getting better. They say most of the system has gone to the south of Charlottesville, and we may get off without anything a little more than a shower, which would be good for Virginia because they need to use their speed against that big defensive line of Notre Dame. Notre Dame comes into this game 9th in the country after that win over Texas. UCLA beating Virginia, so the Cavaliers are 0-1. And we'll send you down to the field to Dr. Jerry Punch and Brian Kelly.
Thanks, Mike. Coach, with so much energy and excitement from the Irish faithful and your players coming off last week's big win over Texas, how tough was it for you to manage their expectations and emotions coming into this game today?
Well, we just felt like, you know, this is going to be a long season, and it's just one step along the way. They've got to come to play every week. Every opponent that we play is going to circle the game against Notre Dame, and they know Virginia's a good team. They're going to play hard. It's their first home game, and they know what to expect today.
Offensively, it all starts with your quarterback, Malik Zaire. What makes him so special?
Well, I think, first of all, he can run the football, so he balances the numbers for us in the run game. And then he's been very accurate. He'll have to continue to do that to keep defenses off balance. So if he can throw the ball effectively with great accuracy, he's very hard to defend.
Hey, Coach, thank you for your time.
Thanks, Jerry.
Moments ago, Cavaliers head coach Mike London in his locker room trying to fire up the troops.
Out there is opportunity. In here is desire. Right here, it's got to be belief.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Opportunity, desire, belief. You got to feel it. Eat it, dream it, sleep it, act like it, talk like it, walk like it. You got to live like it. And the opportunity out there is waiting for you. Control your destiny. Control your destiny.
I like locker room speeches, and that was a good one. A
lot of opportunity, and if you're clicking around channels and seeing Jacksonville State take Auburn all the way into OT and you're a Notre Dame fan, you realize this is college football, and there always is an opportunity for a two-touchdown underdog.
Virginia wins the toss. They defer. Dylan Sims with three touchbacks and five kickoffs, kicking the ball to Amir Carlisle. 4 yards deep. He'll take it there. Malik Zaire leads out the offense. All he did last week was hit 19 out of 22. 86% completion rate, the second best single game ever in Notre Dame history. 13 of 14 on 10-yard completions or more. Only the fifth player in Irish history with 300 passing yards plus in the season opener. And we'll make several references to the best in Notre Dame history. And when we do that, remember, this is a program that wins national championships, produce Heisman Trophy winners. When you talk in terms of history at Notre Dame, you're talking about something special. Run blitz for Virginia. Zaire chased, throws on the run, and overthrows Chris Brown, who had a step on his defender. So John Tenuta, the defensive coordinator, immediately is going to show pressure.
Of course, Tenuta, the defensive coordinator at Notre Dame, two stops ago. He went to NC State for a season. Now at Virginia, has been known to bring a lot of pressure, has more depth now on defense than he's ever had here at Virginia. So they're able to roll more bodies in. Good pickup by the offensive line and good coverage in a full blitz on the back end by Virginia.
Procise turns the corner outside. Procise still on his feet across the 40. Finally taken down shy of the 50. In the spring, C.J. Procise was third on the depth chart. He had never played running back before. He was recruited as a safety, played as a slot receiver. In the spring, they said, hey, let's give you some carries and see what we get at running back. Now he's the starter.
And luckily they did. He's 220 pounds. They lost Arian Foster last week in the third carry of the game against Texas. The starter, Greg Bryan, a guy who was supposed to be at least second string unit carries, academically suspended and then transferred.
Procise runs into a little bit more pressure from Virginia on that one.
That run by Folston, where I'm watching the game, it's just one of those ones. It's hard to tell. One of those cuts there, he popped his ACL, and I think it was a non-contact injury, but with Bryant gone for transfer, Folston out with injury, now you're down to C.J. Procise, who, as you mentioned, played running back for the first time in his life this spring, and two backup freshmen, Josh Adams and Dexter Williams. So some depth hits there, but they certainly have a good athlete in Procise.
Second and long, Virginia may have jumped Zaire. The quick out to his favorite target, Will Fuller. Fuller, in Notre Dame history, had the best sophomore year ever. He had 76 catches, 1,094 yards, third in the country with 15 touchdowns, and that was a free play, gain of 11.
And we were talking to Fuller about the growth of Malik Zaire, the quarterback, of course. Zaire came out of...
He's declined. First down.
We were talking to Will Fuller about the growth of Malik Zaire. He took over, of course, when... Everett Golston decided to take off to Florida State. He said the timing, he feels the game better now, his communication's better. He looked really sharp last week and a good start so far.
Jet sweep to Carlisle. And Virginia handles that one really well. This Cavalier defense has got some speed. Trent Corney.
This guy.
Unusual young man out of Canada.
He is a just a dominant, could be a dominant type of player in his senior year. Incredibly strong. Holds the National Canadian Junior Javelin record. He's an explosive athlete off the edge.
Read option. This is going to get them a first down to Stanley. Gives it or led the way for Josh Adams. Very close now as they move it back a little bit. We told you Corney was an incredible athlete. Watch this.
Out of the pool, this is reminiscent of the J.J. Watt box jump that went viral.
Yes. Are you
kidding?
If you've
never tried that, it's still summertime in most parts of the country, and you got a pool, go to where the water is up to your ribs and try to jump out of it. This guy is an explosive athlete. I think he's going to get a lot of looks at the NFL Combine. He's incredibly strong, incredibly well-built, and plays really hard.
Will be a first down. And, Doc, I know a lot of people can't make that jump out of an empty pool.
Yeah, I know I couldn't, but what a freak of an athlete he is. You know, he squats 630 pounds. He benches for 40. He ties a 150-pound dumbbell on his waist and does pull-ups until he gets, quote, tired. What an athlete.
That is remarkable.
And, you know, we saw Virginia a couple of years ago. This defense is deeper and more athletic than what we saw a couple of years ago. They got beat pretty good against UCLA. Josh Rosen, the quarterback freshman, looked great as Notre Dame decides to take a timeout. But this defense does have some depth, and they do have some guys they can roll through.
We'll take a timeout with them with 12:23 to go first quarter. Notre Dame on its first drive and moving the ball.
Back at Charlottesville just a couple of moments ago after the timeout by Zaire, Brian Kelly, the timeout looked because maybe Zaire thought that was right, was what he said. I think Zaire thought he had the wrong personnel or wrong formation, and Brian says, no, that was right. And you don't want to use a timeout. If it's wrong, use the timeout. But now you have two timeouts instead of three. You never know when you may need those at the end of the half.
Procise back in at tailback. So they changed the formation. Zaire chased out of the pocket. He can run all the way to the Virginia 20. A gain of 16 for Malik Zaire.
Brian Kelly said to Doc Punch right at the start, what was the first thing he said about his quarterback? He can run. I mean, this is completely defended. Zach Bradshaw could not have played that zone read any better. Good blocking by the offensive line so that when Zaire had to cut back, there's nobody there. But decisive runner. Very strong, good cutting ability. Not super explosive, but wow, what a dagger for Virginia.
Three new starters at linebacker for the Cavaliers defense. Good fake by Zaire. Goes deep, Fuller overthrown. Covered beautifully by Maurice Kennedy.
Nice pressure that time by Mike Moore, senior defensive end, whose dad, Sean, was a all-time legend quarterback here at Virginia in the early 90s.
And it's interesting about Moore. They're using him, and you're right, he is a defensive end, but they're using him now at linebacker because they felt they needed more size against Notre Dame.
Yeah, put him stand up on the defensive end, but you see the bodies coming in and out. This is something that John Tenuta didn't have last year, clearly didn't have in the two-win season before. Starting to get a little depth and rolling these guys through.
Procise. Taking a tackler with him, picks up five, maybe six, and it was Trent Corney, that weight room fanatic who had him around the shoulder pads. But strong as he might be, you're not going to get Procise around the shoulder pads without a five-yard ride.
Well, that was what was amazing about Procise. He was a slot receiver last year. He actually led the team at almost 18 yards per catch, but at 220, they experimented with him at running back in the spring. He looked really good, now walked away from the line of scrimmage on third and medium, but what a huge deal that they moved him now that they lost Falston.
Virginia trying to force a field goal attempt here. The Cavaliers may have jumped off sides. The first man was Andrew Brown, number 9, the sophomore, along with David Dean, the veteran left tackle. Zaire may have got him with a hard count, and he did. That's a guy making his third career start to get to 3-5.
And you can't make this mistake if for Virginia. You can't do that if you're Andrew Brown, a sophomore second-year player. And these are the types of mistakes that some of the fans have been complaining about a bit. You've got a team in the red zone, 3rd and 5. You may be able to force a field goal, and now you give them 1st and goal, albeit a tough 1st and goal from about just inside the 10, but just a big mental error by Virginia.
The 3 wide receivers to the right. Virginia was slow to cover it. Now Zaire will pick up the fumble and pick up about 3. It took him a while to get that 3rd defensive back out on that personnel grouping.
Low and left by Nick Martin, the center. Tough to have that snap. And a power run play. Good job by Zaire to pick it up, but he got up a little slow. Had some mud in the helmet there from the bottom of the pile.
Procise on the read, gets maybe 1 before he's thrown back by the middle of that Wahoo defense.
3rd and goal. I think this is where you fake a run, and this is a throwdown. Make Virginia at least honor it. You may empty the backfield, but because Zaire can run, I would want him maybe moving. He's very good, very decisive runner.
Now they're trying to hide Fuller out here in the stack on the right behind Carlisle. Fuller is number 7. Can't jam him if he's the second receiver deep. Zaire looks that direction, throws, and it was tipped apparently over the head of Fuller. He ran a little skinny post. Kennedy was there.
Excellent job by Kennedy, sitting right in the hole. Zaire had all the time in the world. No pass rush whatsoever by Virginia. Kennedy does an excellent job. That's a touchdown if Kennedy's not there. Nixon was beat to the inside on the post route. Nice call, Mike, though. Fuller was stacked so he could wait, and then get there late. This offensive line providing tons of protection.
So Notre Dame forced to settle for the field goal after a drive of over 5 minutes fizzles at the 6-yard line. And Justin Yoon, the freshman, will be on to try the field goal. Tough angle here.
Kicking team, number 19.
You know what? All this does is give them a better angle to kick it.
Well, but, you know, when you talk to officials, their mind's always blown why the opposing coach doesn't decline this.
Decline it.
You can decline any penalty. So if the goal is to back up, then you say, no, we don't want the penalty. They do it again, you decline it again. And that way you don't give them the better angle. And a lot of times for a young kicker, remember, Yoon is a true freshman.
And there that's exactly what Excellent. They're doing. How smart is that?
Nice job by Mike London and his staff. It's amazing. A lot of coaches don't do it, but you can decline any penalty. And with a young kicker who's 1 for 2 on his early career, having him look at a tighter angle, I like this.
Because the distance doesn't make any difference. Just all angle and they fake it. Touchdown, Notre Dame! Holy cow! The tight end, Durham Smythe, carries it into the end zone for a score.
So you don't take the penalty, and then it sets up. What an excellent job by Deshaun Kizer with the fake, the forward. It's actually a pass for a touchdown now. How about that for Kizer? His first touchdown pass in college comes from a forward flip.
He's the backup quarterback. Now they'll line up in an odd formation, force you to defend it. I don't think he got in. He did not. Kizer makes the reception, dives for the goal line that didn't get it, so Notre Dame goes for 2 and doesn't get there. What a start for the Irish. A fake field goal leads to a touchdown. That's the pep rally last night. They're trying to keep that same spirit going this afternoon as Notre Dame pulls off a beautifully executed fake field goal and scores. Mizell on the return. and take it down to the 25-yard line. Now let's take a look at today's good hands play brought to you by Allstate.
Well, great hands by Deshaun Kizer, but watch the blocking by the center move to guard, Nick Martin, and then what a terrific block by Chase Hauschel. Chase was a defensive lineman who was about to graduate. He asked for another year of eligibility, changed to tight end. He had teammates asking, what are you doing back? And, of course, we're going to give the good hands to the tight end who caught it, Durham Smythe, and, of course, Deshaun Kizer. But it was the two blocks by the center, Martin, who'd moved to guard, and the tight end from defensive line, Hauschel. What a great block.
Just perfectly executed. Let's take a look at the Virginia offense. That's Matt Johns. Last week, 21 for 35, 238 yards. Touchdown and an interception against UCLA. Three of his four career starts because he started late last year. 200 or more yards passing. And the fifth quarterback to start for the Cavaliers in the last four seasons. That has been a concern for this program. Mizell, number four, the tailback, and he is just crushed as he took the handoff, and Isaac Rochelle, who could either play inside or outside, drills him.
Completely unblocked. Two offensive linemen ran by him. The fullback, Croce, ran by him. Ooh, and that just a missed assignment. A three-man line look by Notre Dame. And this UVA line, they lost a couple of guys. Lost a starting right tackle, lost a starting left guard during camp, lost some backup help in the middle, so they're good. They're better than they've had, but they're held together by a shoestring.
Johns pressured out of the pack, out of the pocket, can't turn the corner. Virginia was concerned about that front four of Notre Dame, that they could be overpowered by them, and their concerns are proving true. If you watch all day, watch Sheldon Day, number 91. He's double-teamed on the outside that time.
Yeah.
But the defensive coordinator, John Tenuta, said he is a guy who could just ruin everything.
Yeah,
for
Virginia.
He's just that good. Conte to punt. Taken on a hop, and you pay for that one. Wilford Wahi with the big play on special teams. 41-yard kick and no return for the Irish. Date tonight at 8 Eastern on ABC, as well as streaming live on Watch ESPN. You will forgive me in advance, Mr. Cunningham. I think the Oregon defense may have a couple of big quacks in it.
After what happened with Eastern Washington, I have to agree.
Zaire. Good coverage by Tim Harris. It was all over Chris Brown.
A little bit of
Durham Smythe, who made the touchdown play on that fake field goal, just limped off.
Smythe hobbling off. Of course, Notre Dame becoming known for producing NFL tight ends. We have another good one in a true freshman, Alizé Jones, who showed up a little bit against Texas, but Smythe comes off.
But all those other guys right now lacking experience, he was the only one on the roster who had a catch coming into the season. Procise cuts back, still on his feet. Procise keeps his balance. You might be able to figure out why they wanted to give him a shot at running back.
This is what's so hard when there's such good athletes, and Notre Dame just has a ton of them now. But this is dead. This play is completely dead. This is the second time that Zach Bradshaw, the outside linebacker on that side, has been in perfect position. But the defensive line gets pushed down. You saw Mike Moore there, number 32, getting pushed by this offensive line, around allowing the cutback. And this guy, for never having played running back in his life, just started picking it up this spring, certainly seems to have a knack for it.
He started as a slot receiver a year ago. Yeah. Got a timeout on the field. It is a 6-0 lead for Notre Dame here in Charlottesville. What is in the water today?
Well, we started it last week with Northwestern knocking off Stanford.
Oh, sure.
And that was all your fault, according to the Stanford fans.
I can take responsibility for a thing now and then. Flanker screen, Chris Brown. A lot of weapons for this club. Multiple offense, gain of 16. And right now, they're looking just about the same as they did last week when they thrashed Texas.
The one thing I noticed in studying Zaire last week is the touch on the ball. Just a nice, easy, very accurate. It puts it right in front of him, in front of his eyes. Doesn't have to be a fastball. I noticed that a lot. But Zaire takes a little something off of his throws, and that's makes it much easier to catch.
Try the sweep with Josh Anderson, the 5'9 senior, who is fifth on the depth chart in the spring, and Tim Harris will make the tackle.
You know, you go back to the spring depth chart for Notre Dame. Of their first two quarterbacks, Malik Zaire and Everett Golston, and their first two running backs, Torian Folston and Greg Bryant, three of the four are gone. Two transfers, one injured, and now they've got guys fifth down. Josh Anderson coming in, but a couple true freshmen they recruited that are really good.
Second and 12. This is a plan run for Zaire. Weaves his way through the Virginia defense and then does the smart thing out of bounds at the 24. Quentin Nelson was leading him downfield. Ed, the one thing that seems to strike me right now is everybody for Notre Dame is doing their job. If you're supposed to get a block on the corner, they get a block on the corner.
Terrific block by Quentin Nelson. First year as a player, and they just, the word they use for Nelson is mauler. When you hear that about an offensive line, it's like a bear who mauls people. Didn't play last year, and this is where to me, Notre Dame has gotten so much better, clearly better than they were 2012 is on this offensive front.
Josh Adams is in the tailback.
And they were good. They were very good up front in that 2012 team. I just think the depth, as Ronnie Stanley, the left tackle, who's a high draft pick, if he comes out, gets up a little gimpy. Don't want to lose him. This left side of Stanley and Nelson is can be dominant. Nelson is the type of guy at 330 pounds, big, powerful man. You don't want to lose Stanley. This left side is going to be a key, I think, for the playoff run for the Irish.
Stanley's on all the watch lists for awards for linemen. Virginia may have jumped again. Of course, everybody pointing at each other. Cavaliers have already jumped offside twice. Make it three times. And you cannot give Notre Dame extra yards.
We go back to 2012 when we were talking to Brian Kelly this week, and we talked to some of the players, including Joe Schmidt, who didn't play, but he was a redshirt that day. He said it just felt different. The line of scrimmage was just owned by Alabama that day, and Brian Kelly said we went back to recruiting. We tried to change everybody, and Joe Schmidt, that linebacker, said you could tell there was a difference after that 2012 game. The players saw it, they understood it, and they've gotten so much better, more powerful with more depth, especially on that offensive line. That's why when you watch them, they're just better than they were, I think, in 2012.
Second and three. Zaire after the play fake. Maybe about a foot short. Quinn Blanding came up from his safety spot. He's got All-Star written all over him.
Well, the problem now is third and short. This is, you got to defend the run and also the pass. This is somewhere where I would, the way Zaire is playing, you can run it on fourth down. I think you'd go for it on fourth and a foot.
Fuller is covered by Kennedy out here. They'll run for it, and they didn't get it. Adams ran into a lot of resistance and was pushed back, so it's going to be fourth down.
Good penetration by Virginia. And this is a place where I think Brian Kelly should go for it. They have the better team. Defensively, they're playing great. This is awfully conservative to be kicking a field goal inside of a yard. You got to think this offensive line, especially at left side, could get you the push you need.
Justin Yoon We'll try from 32. You don't think fake, do you? Couldn't possibly do it
again. I think they should go for it, so maybe.
And the freshman delivers. So Notre Dame, with two dominating drives, has built a 9-0 lead here in Charlottesville. In 2 days, ESPN will bring you double the NFL game. First, Chip Kelly and his Eagles take on the Falcons. Then Adrian Peterson back to the field as the Vikings face the 49ers and Colin Kaepernick. Coverage of the season premiere doubleheader kicks off with Monday Night Countdown at 5 Eastern on ESPN.
What a bummer for Virginia's defense. There's a couple of Raiders and Bills fans getting ready for the NFL.
Well, Virginia's got to be thinking in that huddle, we've got to do better on this drive. At 3 plays, 4 yards, that won't feed the Bulldog.
But for Virginia defensively, they've got – Brian Kelly's pretty upset. I think that's twice they've gone down inside the 15-yard line. The first time they line up for a field goal and get the fake and score. But that time they get Virginia to jump off sides. They get an extra extra five freebie yards, and then they can't convert it. Fourth and short, decide to kick it instead of go for it.
Tyler Newsom to kick it away. Mizell and Reed are deep. Mizell from the three. A lot of speed, but he can't use it. Cut down at the 20. It has been that dominant as well. Stats at this point do not lie. 120-4. And, of course, this Notre Dame defense showed so well against Texas.
Well, they played so well that Texas decided to make a change in their coaching staff this week. Demoted the offensive play callers. Charlie Strong called a press conference. And from my eye, watching Charlie Strong, he looked nervous. He looked like he's under a lot of stress now at Texas, because that offense didn't play well. And his defense, especially in the secondary, really struggled against the Irish.
Matt Johns fakes the play action and throws underneath. Got a complete Kanan Severin, who had 5 catches a week ago for 58 yards. The only returning wide receiver for the Cavaliers who has more than 20 catches in his career. So the cupboard sort of bare. They were hoping that T.J. Thorpe, a transfer from North Carolina, would help. And they've got Andre Lavroni on the sideline with a back injury. So they are a little thin at that position. Getting a chance to play Olamide Zaccheaus.
Zaccheaus, a true freshman along with David Eldridge, that they feel like has a little bit of a burst, trying to get him involved. And right now, I like what Steve Fairchild, the offensive coordinator, is doing here, is getting away from the line of scrimmage. They're obviously going to have trouble blocking Sheldon Day. They've already had trouble with a couple of assignments, so now trying to use some of that speed. You mentioned Thorpe out, so they're getting Zaccheaus, the true freshman, a touch.
Notre Dame showing 8 men at the line. Now they back out a little bit. Come with 4. Johns on the quick out. Mizell wanted a holding call. He's not going to get it. He was shadowed by Jalen Smith, the middle linebacker. So you get a middle linebacker covering a guy with a nickname of Smoke. Usually that's not going to work out well for you, but it did that time.
Yeah, this week, Brian Kelly saying that Smith is the best player he's ever coached. He said, I've never coached a player like him, period. He can play on the defensive line. He can cover an inside receiver. He can come on the blitz. Really playing at a high level.
Conte will punt it away. C.J. Sanders, is deep. Let's go to Jerry Punch. Doc, what do you have?
Mike, now it's time to bring you up to date with a special story. It's our Bright Side, brought to you by CarMax. Let me introduce you to a young man named Jacob Rainey. Now, Jacob Rainey was a promising high school quarterback in Virginia in 2011. In a game in which looked like a routine play, he dislocated his right knee, rushed to a hospital. The artery was severed. A week later, they had to amputate his right leg above the knee. Now, Jacob refused to quit. 1 year later, folks, he walked back onto the football field as a starting quarterback wearing a prosthetic right leg. As you might expect, when the leg was gone, so were the scholarship offers and all the recruiters except for one. Virginia head coach Mike London said, no, you're the young man I want in my program. courage, heart, and dreams. And today, Jacob Rainey is a student assistant and a member of the Cavalier football team.
What a wonderful story, Doc. I mean, the fact that they stuck with their commitment to him even after that tragic accident, that's terrific. Zaire, short set, throws, plucked right off the grass by Chris Brown.
Nice to have a guy like Brown if you're Malik Zaire. This guy last week took one off the turf on Zaire's first throw. The nerves, I think, were a little hot, and Brown showing the ability to just pull it off the grass. Nice catch last week. Woo-hoo! That's a nice catch. That's a nice catch.
They break a run with Procise again. Procise banged out of bounds by Harris, but it's late, 24 yards on the carry.
Now this time it's the right side getting into the mix. Watch the push here. Excellent job by Steve Elmer, the right guard, got up on the linebacker very quickly.
Procise with six carries for 62 yards so far. And about the only thing that stopped Notre Dame so far is the 10-yard line.
And unfortunately for Virginia, and they do have more depth. We were talking about that earlier on defense. But already you're in the first quarter, and you are just being dragged around the field. This is the third drive of just fighting as hard as you can on every play.
Adams in a tailback. Zaire, another short set, and throws through this one way off target, trying to get it out to Torrey Hunter Jr., whose dad at age 40 is still going in Major League Baseball.
You know, this is somewhere, if you're Notre Dame, you don't want things to get too crazy. You could think of maybe a quarterback draw or maybe even a screen something to Hunter. I don't think you need to get super risky here. If you get it down to fourth down, maybe you go for it on the inside of one. But seem to have this game in control. I don't know how much I'd want Zaire throwing this ball away from the line of scrimmage down the field.
It's third and eight. Cavaliers come on a blitz, picked up beautifully in the pass. Can't be handled by Brown. It was thrown behind and he turned around into coverage. Excuse me, is that Fuller or not Brown?
That's yes, Fuller, yeah. And so far, Zaire just not quite as sharp. This is excellent coverage by Demetrius Nicholson. That ball is way too far on the inside. So right now, Zaire just not as sharp as he was in the bowl game against LSU, nor against Texas last week. But that was a nice job by Nicholson of not giving up more ground. He saw that the route was being cut off, stopped, and made a good jump.
It's a great block by Josh Adams on the blitz to pick up a man. Yoon missed from 45 a week ago. This one from 45. No miss this time. He is 2 for 2. Notre Dame has scored on all three possessions. And they have a 12-0 lead. Meet the new NFL Sunday Morning on ESPN. Start your day off with NFL Insiders Sunday Edition for all the latest headlines and breaking news. Then the Sunday NFL Countdown crew goes inside the storylines as only they can. It all starts at 10 Eastern on ESPN, as well as streaming live on Watch ESPN. Nice to have the NFL.
It's a little noisier for the college game. I kind of like that first weekend where eyes are on the game.
Yeah,
Virginia Tech, Ohio State capped it off Monday night. Cardale Jones got the start. No one knew right until right before the game.
Oh, yes, they did.
Well, they claim they didn't. He is an awfully impressive athlete to watch.
Isn't
6'5", 250 pounds.
You don't hear any defensive backs against him saying, oh, I'm going to get me some quarterback on this run. No, thank you. Boy, could Virginia use a nice return. They need something to go well on special teams or offense. Just being manhandled right now. Newsom, the redshirt freshman, so two brand new kickers for Notre Dame special teams. Mizell will take a knee and they'll bring it out. Mizell got the nickname Smoke in high school when he was so fast they couldn't catch him during tackling drills. He's been behind other pretty good running backs since he came to Charlottesville, but now it's time for Smoke to ignite something because they're counting on him as the tailback.
And he's really good in the open field. He's great in the passing game. He had 8 receptions for 100 yards last week. Not a pure inside runner. They'll go with Albert Reed, and we may see Daniel Hamm as well. But this guy, very good in the open field. Looked really nice a few times against UCLA last week.
Johns with a good play action fake and throws it over the middle complete to Kanan Severin. They'll move him everywhere, so you don't know what kind of defense you should line up in. Nice play for the Cavaliers as we end the first quarter in this presentation of college football. We'll continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. It would be hard to have a more dominant first quarter as Notre Dame carries a 12-0 lead into the second period. It took Virginia till the last play of the period to get its first down. Mizell. Nice cut to get past the line of scrimmage and picks up about 3.
Really nice cut because Sheldon Day was about 2.5 yards in the backfield right when Mizell took that handoff. First down. Virginia does tend to run the ball a little bit. You want to maybe spread it. You're not going to get 91 off the point much for Notre Dame, much less that much penetration. I mean, there was times against Texas where all you saw was 91 in the backfield. Yeah. You wonder if he played for the Longhorns at one point.
They are pretty sturdy up front. Mizell again this time. He'll only get about a yard pushed back. James Onwalu got him around the ankles first. Let's go to the studio. Cassidy Hubbard. Cassidy, thank you very much. Big play here for Virginia. They really need to keep the ball just to keep their defense off the field. Mizell goes in motion. Could have been motion. Looked like the left tackle, Michael Mooney, got an early start from his left tackle spot.
Yeah, and he's going one-on-one.
Six. Offense, 5 yards, penalty, 3rd down.
And Mooney is out there, and they move Sheldon Day over to that tackle spot. And Mooney tried to get a quick jump. Mooney last week had a couple of struggles, really hung in there against a very good UCLA front, but that time jumping early. And once again, here's UVA with another mental error on 3rd down. They've had 2 on defense where they've jumped off sides and now 1 on offense. And this has been one of the biggest complaints of the fan base of this program is penalties, non-competitive penalties.
Makes it 3rd and 11 now. Mizell goes out in the slot. 3-man rush. They still collapse the pocket. And somehow that ball got in there. Severin had to wait on it. Looked like it was tipped, and it stayed up there forever.
Nice job by Mooney. The left tackle gets Day to run right by. The ball is tipped by Isaac Rochelle. The big body in there is having a nice game. But because it was a good route, and Severin, a guy that they really just need. You mentioned T.J. Thorpe is out. There's 3 other receivers out. He's a guy that they really need a big game from.
Looked like 2 Notre Dame DBs had shots at it. Blitz coming. Johns hit as he throws. And Severin inside the 5. Beautiful throw. Joe Schmidt was coming on the blitz. Nailed Johns, but not before he unloaded.
Good read by Johns. Probably didn't see that there was an unblocked linebacker coming, but James Onwalu got sucked up and got run right by Severin. Now, here's what I'll warn Virginia. I don't know that running between the tackles is what you want to do in here. There are too many bodies. You've got 1st and goal. You have to have a touchdown here. You have to score a touchdown. There is no field goal in this ball game. So just be careful seeing what you're going to try to do between the tackles with this many white jerseys packed in this close to the line of scrimmage.
How do you have a mismatch like that with their only really truly dangerous wide receiver being covered by an outside linebacker?
Because Severin has been moving position to position. That time he switched over to the other side. That's exactly what they're trying to get Brian Van Gorder to do, is have to cover with linebackers.
You're watching ESPN on ABC.
Lambeth Field here at Virginia, with Lohr has it, the first forward pass was thrown on that field in this game. Mizell trying to get to the outside, knocked out of bounds short. Trying to use that speed, but Isaac Rochelle, the big defensive lineman, wouldn't let him turn the corner.
Rochelle did an excellent job of reading this and staying in position. That's a tough spot. That ball should be on the 1 yard line, not the two. And I know 1 yard doesn't sound like much, but inside the five, that spot looks like it could have been much better for Virginia. I like the call, though. Get away from the middle of this defensive line. That's not where the money is down here for Virginia.
Only one wide out. It's Keon Johnson to the right. Give it to Reed, and the Maryland transfer is stuffed. It's asking a lot for that offensive line to move Notre Dame's front.
And you just can't have delay. If you're going to run it inside, if you've got guys blocking back, Jack McDonald, the guard, gets caught up, doesn't even get to his block because the linemen are all getting pushed back. He trips on those feet. This is not a place where you want to be running between the tackles. It's not something Virginia has done well historically. Not quite the inside runner in Mizell. Now you're stuck in a place where you're going to have to throw it.
Severin isolated on the right side. Mizell goes in motion. They look his way. They throw over the middle to the tight end, Evan Butch. Touchdown. That was really well designed. They got all the defenders to follow the people who were in motion and spreading out, left the middle open, and a good throw by Matt Johns.
Nice call, too, by Steve Fairchild, the offensive coordinator.
Yes, it
was. Bunch of big bodies over there. And Butts, a redshirt freshman that they feel will be a big help in the passing game, starts to pay off.
Ian Fry will come on for the point after. And Mike London said earlier this week, you know, I really love Ian Fry, but I want him kicking extra points and not field goals. He'll get his wish on this one.
And if you're Notre Dame, after what felt like an incredibly dominating first quarter, you're going to be up by five.
Virginia hadn't even gotten a first down until this drive. They go 75 yards in 8 plays, and they score on Notre Dame. To Charlottesville, Virginia, and college football was in danger of disappearing in the early 1900s because it was such a dangerous game to play. First field that had 4 quarters that was ever played on it. The first time a pass would be thrown past the line of scrimmage, that was in 1910. Notre Dame will down it, and Ed, take a look at that TD again.
Well, Notre Dame fans, turn your head away as we watch Charlie Hopkins, who at the very beginning does look like he's running a route, but then at the end looks like he's blocking Jalen Smith. And that allows Butts to sneak in. The reason I say turn your head, Notre Dame fans, is because remember last year against Florida State when Corey Robinson was called for offensive pass interference on what looked like a pass by Everett Golson that would have won the game. I'm not sure you should have called offensive pass interference there on UVA, but by the end of the play, he was no longer running a route, even though it looked like it at the start.
So after getting nothing, Virginia comes out and goes 75 yards to score. Josh Adams will check in for Notre Dame. He'll play tailback at the start of this series. And they'll see if the Cavalier defense can stiffen. Zaire, nice play fake. Gets all he can out of it, out to the 33. Trent Corney chased him down. He went after Josh Adams instead of the quarterback.
Excellent job by Zaire. Corney decides to go right for the running back, and Zaire pulls it. And this is a He's better at this than Everett Golson was. So you lose Everett Golson, of course, who's a terrific playmaker but had a bunch of turnovers at the end of the year. But the zone read is a better play.
Procise back in. And another big play. This kid is an elite talent. Kelvin Rainey made the tackle downfield.
But the zone read is a much bigger element now than it was with Golson. Golson would run it. Of course, he's having to run it some at Florida State. But Zaire just has a better feel for it. And it's hard to believe that Procise isn't even in the running back mix until an experiment in spring ball. He sure looks like a natural.
Flanker screen will go absolutely nowhere to Amir Carlisle because Maurice Canada diagnosed it and Chris Brown couldn't block him.
Canada having a nice game. You know, last week against UCLA, Josh Rosen, the true freshman quarterback, he was just never pestered, was able to step up into the pocket, played really well. But the secondary for UVA, they weren't getting torched. I mean, that young guy was throwing the ball, as John Tenuto said, he was dropping it into a Coke bottle on us. And this secondary does have some veterans. They get Nicholson back, so.
There he goes again. Procise. There is almost no wasted motion in what he does. Just very calm, easy cuts, and finds a way to get more yardage.
Watch the block here by the fullback. The H-back, Smythe, gets a cut block on Corney, and that is exactly where the cutback is. Now, that's the hardest part now. The offenses are able to get someone back to that cutback side and block as well. So you don't have to beat the unblocked man anymore.
Nine carries, 100 yards so far for Procise in the first half. He'll get another crack at it. Still on his feet. The first man never seems to do anything to him.
And you go, he was a defensive back. Then he was a wide receiver, a starting slot receiver for this team last year. During the spring, Brian Kelly is a new quarterback coach and co-offensive coordinator. Mike Sanford, Mike Denbrock, the other co-offensive coordinator, they said, let's give this guy a try. He's 220 pounds. He'd had some carries, but just on jet sweeps and things like that. He never played running back in high school or here until just this spring. He's tough.
Josh Adams checks in to give Procise a blow. Zaire on the keeper. Well, Virginia almost jumped off sides again.
This is a down, and I would suspect we're going to see a run play from Brian Kelly here. I think they feel like they're in total control. But, you know, as the season goes on, this is where you'd want to see them get someone like Durham Smythe, one of those tight ends, some type of run action, see if you can get not on the third down, see if you can't pick up something bigger, even a touchdown. I think they'll run it because they're in such control. But as you get down in the season, you start playing teams like USC, etc. These are the plays that you can try to take a shot on.
Fuller to the near side as a wide receiver. They fake it to Procise. Zaire will keep, and it looks like he's a half yard, maybe short.
And this has been troublesome for Notre Dame early in this game. They are not able to finish off drives. The only touchdown coming on a fake field goal, and I think this is a great call by Brian Kelly to go for it. I felt like he should have on the last fourth and one going the other way, but I wouldn't suspect anything different. Procise is a good inside runner, maybe another zone read.
Place will explode if Virginia can hold on defense. Procise. I don't think so. The middle of that Cavalier line stood tall.
Brian Kelly told us the strength of this team is the offensive line. And there was just too much push at the point of attack. Really nice penetration. Excellent penetration by Andre Miles Redmond and also David Dean. Both guys got up under the pads of the guards and centers. An excellent job. Not a battle you expect Notre Dame to lose after seeing what they did to Notre Dame. But that time, lower pad level, better explosion by the defensive front of Virginia.
It's all leverage in there, yeah, if you're smaller, isn't it?
And Dean's a shorter guy, 6 foot 6'1", played a ton of ball, really recognizes formations, understands what linemen are trying to do to him, and that time got a good jump on the ball, as did Miles Redmond.
See if the Virginia offense can crank up another big play here. Johns with time. Now under pressure, they get him from behind, but not before he gets out to the 29-yard line. Gain of 5, Romero Okwara.
Yeah, we met with Matt Johns yesterday. He was talking about the spring battle he had with Grayson Lambert. A lot of people thinking Lambert might have a little edge in ability, but the truth is this guy won the job. He told us, I came in, I just had a mindset I was not going to lose, and I give the coaches credit. Steve Fairchild, the offensive coordinator, said, no, you're our first guy coming out of spring, and then Lambert decided a second string to take off.
Mizell finally has a hole to run through and then is smacked as he got up to the 34 right at the sticks.
You know, Brian Kelly, we were talking about that Texas game, Mike. You asked him, are you the best team in the country or are they the worst team in the country? And he said, probably somewhere between. But he said, if we play with that energy and our quarterback plays at that level, we're a very good team. Well, right now, Notre Dame is not playing with that energy level, and Malik Zaire has looked nothing like he did against Texas. So all of a sudden, you come on the road, 2 touchdown favorites, a team in Virginia that has had a big win at home in September the last 3 years, starting to feel it a little bit.
Johns in the pistol formation. And
Virginia. Timeout, Virginia. That's their second timeout. The first half. Media timeout.
Got 5:19 to go in the first half in a 5-point ball game. As well as streaming live on Watch ESPN. Virginia has regained some momentum in this game. Screen to Reed. And just tripped up as he gets out to about the 48-yard line. Kavari Russell, who was academically ineligible a year ago and came back to really help him in the secondary, made a saving tackle.
Sure did. Excellent setup screen. Excellent job by the center, Jackson Mateo. He got out and got just enough of Jalen Smith. Otherwise, that would have been tackled for about a 1-yard gain.
Johns sets up, throws short underneath to his tight end Charlie Hopkins, making his second catch. Somebody that took advantage of the that senior graduation rule. He's a graduate from Stanford.
The new one and done of college football, the graduate transfer. If you graduate from a university and the school you're at does not have the graduate degree you're looking to get, you can transfer. Of course, it seems to be happening more for athletic reasons sometimes than academic.
The NCAA really needs to take a look at that and say, this is what we thought was going to happen and we're fine with it, or this rule's being abused and we have to do something about it. One or the other. They just can't let it go on the way it has.
Yeah, and a lot of student athletes, especially at the quarterback position, some of those positions are coming in. And of course, Brian Kelly, both of these coaches lost quarterbacks that were in the mix. Brian Kelly says that it was neck and neck for Zaire and Golson coming out of spring. Golson wanted to change. But I give Kelly credit. He said, look, we're asking them to get their degree, and if they complete that, then they have the right to transfer.
Very true.
No sour grapes by him on this deal.
No, he was very open and honest about it. 3rd and 4, blitz coming. The pass underneath, complete to Severn. He's got enough for the first down. Had his legs cut out from under him by Cole Luke. Virginia's found something that works for them right now.
And Matt Johns looks great. When I was studying, you know, you watch the TV copy, you watch the game a little bit. When you go in and you watch the All-22, you see everyone, you see the line of scrimmage play on the coach's film where the coaches tape it. And in studying this, Matt Johns was in pretty good control, and now they'll go with a Wildcat formation, which they've done a few times.
And Reed will give it to Mizell, back to Johns, and they're going to throw off of it. Has a man wide open. It is a touchdown to Keon Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
Notre Dame tricked Virginia earlier in the game on a fake field goal. You could just hear the Virginia coaches thinking to themselves, if you like that one, you're going to love this one. Beautifully executed.
9 of 10. Matt Johns is on fire. He's having... Zaire's been off a bit. He was so sharp last week. Now it's Matt Johns' turn.
We asked earlier, is there something in the water? There may be. Look at this play. What a throw to Johns, and Keon Johnson wide open. Laid it right in his lap. Welcome back to the ACC on ESPN. We're in Charlottesville, Virginia, and they are going nuts at Scott Stadium. And why not? They're up on Notre Dame 14-12.
And it looked like the Cavs were about to get run out of the building in that first quarter.
Yes,
so quite
did.
A turn.
Amir Carlisle on the return. Out to the 20 and no more. Let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary, Mr. Cunningham.
Well, it all started when Brian Kelly called the fake field goal. Deshaun Kizer does the shovel pass to Durham Smythe, who walks in. Then the reverse throwback and then blown coverage on the backside. Kavari Russell got caught peeking to the inside. Safety and Russell both misreading the play and allowing Johnson to run right by them to shock the, I don't know, 15, 20,000 Irish fans who showed up to Scott Stadium and are watching by the millions around the world.
A lot of green and gold here, just like there is every place that they go. Zaire under pressure. Got away from one, got away from two. And throws the ball out of bounds, trying to hit Procise at the sideline. Mike Moore had a shot at him, missed him initially. Moore almost got him a second time.
We talk a lot about Zaire and his presence and how good he is during workouts and how everyone trusts him. One of the biggest things that people love about him is his ability to do this. He's a 220-pound guy. He's built more like a running back, really, than he is a quarterback. A very good thrower. But to go from instead of second and 15 or 17 to second and 10 is a huge save.
He is only 4 out of 11 after being so accurate a week ago. This pass out in the flat is complete to Carlisle, a former running back. Micah Kizer, excellent coverage.
And the good news for Virginia is even though they lost their two best pass rushers from last year in Max Vallis and Eli Harold, they're getting some pressure, and it's not just by the blitz. John Tenuta, the guy who everyone thinks is a crazy mad blitzer, but they're getting pressure with their front as well.
Zaire changing the play. Third down has not been kind to Notre Dame, and that looked like Mike Moore jumped and forced the tackle to move, but we'll see.
Number 68 on the offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
Mike McGlinchey said he moved early.
And the rule is if Moore is in the neutral zone when McGlinchey moves, that the penalty should be on defense. But I'm not so sure that Moore was in the neutral zone before McGlinchey glinched.
McGlinchey glinched?
Isn't that a verb?
It is now. Third and 9, third down has not been all that good to Notre Dame. Zaire with time, floats it. Incomplete, great coverage by Nicholson. Trey Nicholson, stride for stride with the All-American candidate Will Fuller.
And both guys at the end of it doing some hand fighting. Good no call by the official. But Nicholson, a guy who missed the better part of the last two seasons. Once again, very good pressure by Virginia. But Nicholson and Fuller both pushing off. I like that there was both guys using hands. But Nicholson, a guy who had turf toe, lucky to have him back.
booming kick taken by Saunders across the 30. 56-yard punt, 4-yard return. Coming up, John Saunders and Company, along with the Cooper Tires halftime report. And some shockers today in college football and some games that could have been shockers.
Well, now for Virginia, you get the ball back. You only have one timeout left. Both teams with one timeout left, but Notre Dame not able to get anything going offensively. Malik Zaire being pressured so far by Virginia, just a totally different game than against Texas. And now the last two drives, this guy's been hot with a timeout. I would be very aggressive if I were Virginia at the 32-yard line here. This is a good deal for them.
Johns out to Reed, trying to get a little screen action going, and stopped immediately by Jalen Smith, the middle linebacker. All the Virginia coaches, when they looked at Notre Dame's defense, says, just look at 91, 9, and 6. Says these guys are draft picks.
And that was the same screen we saw a moment ago where Jalen Smith almost made the play but was blocked. And that time, and now Virginia just taking forever to get people on and off the field. And that now, clearly, Virginia's going to play it very conservatively. I'm not sure how in the world you take this much time with a timeout and the way this quarterback is playing to get this offensive playoff.
I think after they lost 3 yards on that first play, they decided discretion is the better part of valor.
And discretion, that level of being conservative, when you've got somebody like Notre Dame on the ropes and your quarterback's playing this well, I'm not sure why you wouldn't try to get a couple of more balls down the field. I know you feel good with a lead going into halftime, but this is a team that's loaded with NFL talent for Notre Dame. Their quarterback has not played well in the first half. Why wouldn't you take advantage of this?
Well, remember the pregame speech Mike London gave? Think of the speech he can give at halftime.
Yeah. I just think, you know, you're such big underdogs. You had a tough start to the season. You get the ball in good field position. One bad play, I don't think, has you just throw out being aggressive.
What a first half. Our score, Virginia 14, Notre Dame 12. When we come back, John Saunders and company bring you up to date on the Cooper Tires halftime report after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
The following is a presentation of ESPN on ABC.
Welcome back to the ACC on ESPN. And if you joined us late, this one is hard to believe. Virginia, a team that got whacked a week ago against UCLA. And Notre Dame would just ramble all over Texas. Virginia's winning at the half.
The quarterback came in, Malik Zaire, who was as hot as there was in the country. But he's being matched by Matt Johns, and our AT&T strong performance is the first half performance by Johns. He's only had one incomplete pass, and while this seems like a simple thing, the screen, it's thrown perfectly. It hits Albert Reed right in stride, thrown very softly. Good blocking by the offensive line. Almost a huge play. And then takes a hit, but delivers a great strike to Severin. And this was exactly the matchup that they wanted. That is a outside linebacker on a receiver, and they've been moving Seven around, able to get him the matchup they were hoping for. But Johns has been like Zaire was last week against Texas. He hasn't missed anything.
Take a look at our halftime double check brought to you by State Farm. Virginia with half of its yardage on two plays. First three drives for Notre Dame, they were completely dominant with 164 yards. Three scores, the last two drives, only 51 yards total. And Johns, as Ed pointed out, nine straight completions, and Virginia gets the ball to start this half.
And Notre Dame, even that touchdown was on a field goal alignment. They were going to kick it, and they took a penalty, and then Virginia declined that penalty, so they had a fourth and one, and They have really run into mud. They've been fine up until about the 20-yard line, Notre Dame has, and not been able to finish the drive.
Touchdown apiece on trick plays. Mizell wrapped up the line of scrimmage, spins forward Daniel Page. 315-pound tackle wrapped him up. Mizell. Notre Dame has more size on both sides of the ball up front than I can remember in years. Johns over the middle, double team, and the ball pops loose, intended for Johnson. Cole Luke had the primary coverage, number 36.
Luke, a young man who got a bunch of time last year with Kavari Russell, who had to sit out the year because of academic issues. Russell, of course, back now. But Luke was a guy who got a ton of reps at that spot with Russell out.
I hope people call him Cole Hand Luke. I hope. Blitz coming. Johns hangs in the pocket over the middle, incomplete. Some contact down the middle. Severin wanted a flag.
Well, yeah, they missed
it. There it is.
Yeah, they missed a pass interference on Butler.
After the play, dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 98 on the defense, 15-yard, automatic, first down.
It's Andrew Trombetti. No interference call, but Trombetti gets hit for 15 yards.
Devin Butler got away with pass interference or defensive holding on that one, but Trombetti gets the unsportsmanlike conduct. So Virginia now getting a break. It was Virginia early in the game, remember, that was making the little errors that kept the drive going. This one they get away with the PI, but get the personal foul.
Mizell hit by that man, Sheldon Day. That's an all-day sucker there. I mean, you try to block him, you're going to need two guys.
Not much help on the backside there. That was Eric Smith, the right tackle. Didn't get a whole lot of help from Ross Burbank, the right guard, on that play. You've really got to shore this guy up. He's too quick, too fast. Not a huge guy, but plays so low to the ground and so powerful and quick, he's tough to get under.
Projected as a second, perhaps a first-round draft choice. Mizell, on the fly sweep, takes it up to the 47-yard line. They need to get to the Notre Dame 49 for a first down.
Nice positive play, though, to get yourself into a more convertible third down. We were talking to Steve Fairchild. He said, if we can stay under third and six on average, we'll be fine. Well, this good call there got them to third and four. Now you have everything in your playbook. You have the run, the throw, the draw, the screen. Tough to defend third and four.
Mizell goes to the slot. Albert Reed, number five, the running back. Four-man rush. Underneath to Mizell. He's got the first down. Short, controlled passing game, and Johns calm enough to wait until his receivers get open.
This is, and we studied Virginia a couple years ago, this offensive line is so much better than where they were a couple of years ago. And they're missing two starters. They're missing a starting right tackle and a starting right left guard to injury. And against a front that looked unblockable at times against Virginia, starting to get a little tired, and the time of possession starting to flip, and this offensive line playing really well.
Fake to Reed. Flag is down as the receiver fell. Severin was the intended receiver. Cole Luke was there, and they'll hit him with the flag for interference.
Pass interference, defense, number 36, 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
Ryan Van Gorder with the nod. And there's the hold, because when the ball was thrown, the ball was in the air, so not defensive holding, pass interference, but you probably may have thought that ball was uncatchable. Well, it was uncatchable because
of the interference.
10 yards before he was truly into his pattern. And Virginia, looking like Oregon here on offense. They've been going up and down the field since the second quarter.
Two big penalties have aided this drive. Jordan Ellis, number 10, is the tailback. And the referees will whistle this one dead.
Delay of gain. Offense. Number 15. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Boy, Matt Johns really upset at the Virginia sideline, yelling at the coaching staff.
There's no way you're taking a delay of game there. Not once you get down inside the 40 and you have a first and 10. That's a really tough penalty. And if there were some, and now look.
Boy, late substitutions.
Yeah, it just seems to be overthinking maybe a bit on the Virginia sideline.
Play clock's already nine.
Yeah, this is a bad management to get the penalty and now have to rush.
Get the playoff in time to Reed, and Reed first through, still on his feet down to the 21-yard line. Well, they got it in really late, but it turned out to be a good one.
Excellent job by the left side of the offensive line. Michael Mooney blocked down Jack McDonald with the kick out. A huge hole for Albert Reed. More of a inside tackle runner transfer for Maryland than Mizell is. But that was a really nice blocking on the left side. A huge hole. Reed didn't have to make a cut until he was about 5 yards beyond the line of scrimmage.
You're the Cavaliers. You're starting to believe. Mizell, little option action. Taken down by the safety, Elijah Shoemate.
You know, Mike, I'm sitting here starting to believe. This was a game coming in. After seeing what Notre Dame did to Texas and then watching some of the UCLA, I thought, that Notre Dame was 2-touchdown favorite coming in this game. I thought it might be more after studying the game. This is shocking to me that Virginia's playing this well. And right now, Notre Dame just has no fire at all on defense. They are getting blocked.
And you can tell Virginia is playing with a great deal of confidence. Albert Reed, the transfer from Maryland, who was used last week in the Wildcat formation, something he had done in high school and in college.
And this is a really important red zone trip here. Red zone inside the 25-yard line. Called that because you expect a blitz. I'm not sure that Van Gorder needs to bring pressure here. I think you got to play tighter coverage, though, because it's 3rd and 5, but for Virginia, the way Matt Johns has been playing, this is a throw down. You've got two backs to help with protection. Give him some time.
Severin has already made 5 catches. He's flanked to the top of your screen, number 9. Blitz coming. Johns intended for Severin, and he caught it. That baby was up for grabs. He could see a blue jersey downfield and says, I'm going to give it a shot.
That was good recognition by Severin. There is a flash. A little bit of a push off there by Severin, but they called, I believe, Jack McDonald, the left guard. I believe they got Jack McDonald, the left guard, for holding. I didn't see the flag down. But left guard, and that was, he was trying to block one-on-one with Sheldon Day, who had beat him to the inside. And they got McDonald. Day beat him right at the snap. He had to ride him on the hip, and they got him for holding. Big call.
They have to get to the 11-yard line for a first down. 4-man rush. John steps up over the middle, intended for Severin. And, boy, if he catches that ball, going to be lights out, because Max Redfield, the safety, was coming. He saw him out of the corner of his eye and went low.
Yeah, and John's a little late on this throw, and you can't blame Severin here. Well, you really do not want to see a guy drop his head like that. I hope that Notre Dame looks at Redfield and they show him that tape and say, son, you can't dive in with your head down like that. You're going to hurt yourself or the other player and potentially get thrown out of the game.
Ooh, that would have been evil. And Virginia fails to convert on the field goal as well. What a turnaround. It's a two-point ball game in Charlottesville as we check in with Dr. Jerry Punch.
Yeah, I spoke with Brian Kelly, Mike, about the lack of offense for the Irish in the second quarter. He said it's missed opportunities. We got to be able to convert on third down, fourth down, and we got to have touchdowns instead of field goals. We've been shooting ourselves in the foot.
And Virginia did the same thing on this last possession, Jerry. They missed a 43-yard field goal at the end of that drive after a major penalty kept them from being down at the 10-yard line.
Yeah, holding on the left guard. We've talked about Sheldon Day for Notre Dame defensively, and Steve Fairchild, the offensive coordinator for Virginia, said he can just ruin the whole thing. Well, that time he ruined the whole thing. Someone had the ball inside the 10, first and goal. Instead, they come up with a missed field goal.
Zaire has been relatively inaccurate in this ballgame, certainly compared to the first one against Texas, where he was nearly perfect, but he's not thrown the ball well today.
And really tight coverage again by Trey Nicholson. He's got some depth at that cornerback position with Tim Harris and Canaday. Now they've got Notre Dame in third and long. Haven't had to blitz much, so they can play some coverage. This has been a shocking game, to say the least.
And Quinn Blanding, the safety, was the ACC Defensive Rookie of the Year a season ago. So they're strong there, too. Third and long for Zaire, changing the play. Virginia shows blitz and they come. Zaire can't get out of there. Micah Kaiser, the middle linebacker, came from the left side on the blitz and would not let Malik Zaire get away.
Well, this is just blown protection. Hard to tell who misses it, but nobody picks up Kaiser. The offensive line slides to the left. The tight end to that side releases. I'm not sure. Potentially the quarterback, Malik Zaire, missed it, but that's a free run for Micah Kaiser. Mental bust.
Newsom, a monster kick that will be down at the 11-yard line. We've got a timeout, 8:42 to go, third quarter. Virginia standing tall again in a two-point game.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Chevrolet. Find new roads. Chick-fil-A. We didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich. And Jiffy Lube. Experts around every corner to help you leave worry behind.
It's the Paramount Theater in Charlottesville. All wide variety of entertainment there. Musicals, movies, concerts. Opened in 1931. It was closed in 1974, as so many beautiful old theaters were, but had a facelift after 30 years and reopened in 2004. Old movie theaters are just really neat. Virginia trying to reignite its offense. They have, since the start of the second quarter, moved the ball better than Notre Dame has, haven't they?
After watching UVA against UCLA last week, UCLA is awfully good on defense. And they kept battling. Some of their offensive linemen were having really tough days, but they didn't give up. Their technique stayed sound. That's one thing the Notre Dame coaches said when you watched Virginia. They are well coached. Do they have the playmakers to make it happen? And Mac Johns just playing really well. He's starting to feel his role as a starting quarterback and leader.
Empty backfield. Mizell underneath. They threw it behind him this time. Mizell had gotten past Anawalu.
And that was one of those throws Johns wanted back right when he let it go. Mizell was there. It was a first down or third and very short. Johns just missed him.
Now, people applauding right now are wearing green Notre Dame unis. Anything better than a leprechaun?
Yeah, a pot of gold.
They're connected. Johns all day to throw. Now under pressure and goes down at the 15. The Notre Dame pass rush finally got there. Elijah Shoemate and Jalen Smith.
Just terrific coverage by the secondary. And Johns, who is athletic enough to run, almost feel like it's third and seven. This is going to be hard to pick up. But you almost feel like he should have taken off there still trying to look downfield. Jalen Smith finally coming over to help close it off. It maybe take off a touch sooner, but you can't fault the guy for keeping his eyes down the field. But terrific coverage by the Irish.
Booming punt. Sanders driven back to his 33. Still on his feet out to the 42-yard line. Nice return by Sanders. 8 yards after a 52-yard kick. Notre Dame ball when we come back. Check out Scott Van Pelt Midnight all weeknights. It's a great show. Had a terrific interview last night about the U.S. Open tennis with Tom Rinaldi and what happened in that remarkable upset. It was very entertaining to listen to.
Yeah, the upset of Serena Williams, you put that down as one of the biggest upsets
ever
in sports history. Yeah,
absolutely. Can Notre Dame get its mojo back? Zaire airs one out. Fuller, got it! Mojo returned. That was not an easy catch to make. Threw it over the outside shoulder, but Fuller got it for 59 yards and 6 points.
And when Zaire let this go, I thought for the world he had overthrown Fuller. Fuller had about a half a step on Trey Nicholson when that ball left. And then it became about 2.5 steps by the time the ball got there.
Did.
He has a little different gear.
Yeah, he's got fifth.
He might have ludicrous speed.
Came in. Well, he told us he runs in the low 4.4s. I think he might be kidding about that.
Yeah, it might be a bit faster, actually.
Yes.
Some guys'
exactly.
Game speed, though, is unmeasurable. He seems to be that type of guy who just has that extra gear.
Well, that was a 59-yard drive in 8 seconds. That's efficient. And Notre Dame has regained the lead here in Charlottesville. Notre Dame dominated in the first quarter, but they had to fight their way back here in the third to regain the lead over the Wahoos here in Charlottesville. Now Virginia will get the ball back on the kick. And Trey just couldn't cover the speed of Fuller. High short kick, Mizell from the six. Flags down everywhere. Looked like a block in the back on the first man.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 11 on the return team. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
And the touchdown is just speed, isn't it?
Yeah, there's not much to analyze here, actually. Nicholson does a pretty good job in the back pedal, but Fuller right there just caught him just not turning out of his back pedal just soon enough. Fuller, guy who's really starting to come into his own. He knows every position at receiver on the field that can move him around. He's starting to get a good feel. He was talking about the post route he ran for a touchdown against Texas when we were talking to him this week. Just has a better feel for when defensive backs aren't ready to turn, reading their hips, and that time Nicholson didn't quite get out of his break fast enough, but that's just a guy running by somebody.
And Fuller did the good thing. He hung it up there, threw it as far as he could. Or Zaire did, and Fuller ran right under it. Reed across the 10 out to about the 13-yard line. Daniel Cage brought him down.
Virginia speeding up a little bit, going with a little tempo here on offense. We haven't really seen this so far. Nice little change if it works.
Flanker screen, Mizell. Beautifully defensed by Notre Dame. Elijah Shoemate got out there. Onwalu got out there.
I just never had a chance. Shoemate did an excellent job coming from that inside safety position. Virginia went fast. You go fast. Are you ready to run the play? Don't have to necessarily go fast. They were trying to catch Notre Dame off guard. It didn't work.
This has certainly been a game of momentum, and the Irish fans hoping Notre Dame has it now for good.
Number
snap infraction. Number 50 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Is that one of you tricky centers trying to do in the defense?
No, I think Jackson Mateo may have flinched a little bit.
Well,
he must. He had to have moved it earlier before before we came into that picture for it to be. But this is another pre-snap error for Virginia to take a third and five, a manageable distance to a third and 10, where with the defensive front of Notre Dame, awfully hard to hold them out.
Screen, Mizell. Boy, is that good defense or what?
And the concern here for Steve Fairchild, the offensive coordinator for Virginia, if we drop back and pass, and Jalen Smith just does an awesome job, fights off the block of Keon Johnson. Johnson, the young man who caught the touchdown earlier on the flea flicker reverse pass. But Smith, a guy who Brian Kelly thinks is the best player on defense he may have ever coached. You can see how active he is and athletic he is on his feet there.
He was a Butkus finalist last year for the award for the best linebacker in the country. Sanders takes it on the bounce. Drilled. It looked like Reed as he returned to 10 yards after a 59-yard kick. ESPN College Football. Stream every game live at home or on the go. Just download the Watch ESPN app or visit watchespn.com.
Sure, a lot of people were watching that app when Jacksonville State was taking Auburn into overtime and ended up losing.
If you predicted that one, give yourself a gold star.
Well, if you predicted this one, too, I don't know that anybody in the country would have thought Virginia would be in this game late in the third quarter. But now you start to feel a little bit. Virginia got very conservative there on that third down. I'm not blaming them. They're deep in their own territory.
Right.
Pass rush has been very good for Notre Dame.
Look at those numbers, though. I mean, 313 yards a week ago, held under 100 so far in this one, although the last possession, the bomb, helped those numbers, and it helped Notre Dame. Zaire, quarterback draw, a lot of room to run. Zaire to the 17-yard line. 39 yards on a quarterback draw.
Well, they'd gotten away from the quarterback run there for about the last quarter and a half. And this time it's a quarterback run the whole way. There's not even a play fake. This is direct snap, might as well be a wildcat run. An excellent job by the left side of that line. We've been talking about left tackle Ronnie Stanley and Quentin Nelson, the big powerful left guard. That time they blew up the right side of the defense for Virginia.
Wasn't touched by a human hand for a long, long time. Procise, who was so active early, hasn't had many opportunities lately.
Procise, a native of the Commonwealth of Virginia. This is the first time Notre Dame has ever played in the state. Of course, Notre Dame has a ton of alumni all over the country, a lot in the Washington, D.C. area, so a lot of them came down for today's game.
Zaire. They wanted a wide receiver screen to Chris Brown, but there was a hesitation. I think Brown stopped the pattern, and Zaire had to double clutch.
I think Zaire saw all of those blue jerseys and thought, wait a minute, I'm not going to try to stick this in there. So he double clutched, and then Brown didn't want to go in that mess either. And here's Notre Dame, the same problem they had. Third and six, you get down inside the 20, the same problem they had in the first quarter. Not able to pull it off. This is somewhere with everybody out of the backfield. This is where Zaire could take off.
Delay of game. Offense. Number 8. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
He may have been trying to draw Virginia offsides. He's done that a couple of times before.
But you don't want to take that penalty, even if you're trying to do that. And both teams kind of trading mental errors here. Now, you probably throw in the quarterback draw out, not saying that Zaire won't run, but now if you're Virginia.
Fuller is flanked wide to the near side. They're going in that direction. He's covered man-to-man by Trey Nicholson. And they'll have to send on the field goal team.
Complete miscommunication. Will Fuller did not know what route he was running. That was Zaire, I think, was expecting him to run an out. Fuller was running right in, and Nicholson wasn't even about to make a break when the throw was made. And here's been the problem all day for Notre Dame is field goals instead of touchdowns.
Justin Yoon has hit from 32 and 45, but he has missed from 34. Excuse me, this is from 34. And he got it. No, it's wide. Well, from the shot we had, I thought that was through.
Yoon, one of the highest-ranked recruits in the country, starting off rough. He's now missed three field goals in the first two ball games of the season, one against Texas, and now this one. Looked like a good hold, just pushed it to the right. The laces were off to the right, and that might have pulled the ball a little bit that way, but Notre Dame offensively just unable to get it done inside the 20 today. It has been really tough on them.
Usually teams that can't run the ball bog down in that area, but they can run it. So Virginia goes back to offense with 3.5 minutes to go third quarter.
I think they really need to let Matt John settle in, let him continue to throw on downs that may feel like rundowns. Very accurate today. Traded off last year, of course, with Grayson Lambert, and then Lambert transferred after spring practice to Georgia, and John's had a really good spring, stepped up his game. The way he's played, second and nine, I would look to get something out of my quarterback here. I'm not sure I'm running it again.
He's hit 13 out of 18 throws. Play action fake here. Flanker screen to Mizell. Makes one man miss, but he can't make the second or third man miss, and he crosses to the 26.
And one thing that Virginia has had to do, and one thing they have not had, is they've never really had a big outside playmaker. They just, since Mike Lennon has been here, they haven't had a guy like Will Fuller to stretch the field. So they do have to work the underneath stuff quite a bit, and that time was a nice job to get back to a third manageable. The only guy we've seen down the field really is Severin, number nine. Lined up in the slot on Russell.
Blitz coming. They pick it up. Johns with time and overthrows. Well, credit that Virginia front wall. They really held out the blitz and gave Johns plenty of time, but he threw it high into coverage in Redfield. The safety had a better shot at it than anybody.
And was looking for Severin, working the inside route on Russell. That ball just looked like it got away from him, falling back a little bit as he throws it. And this ball was 8 or 10 feet over the head of the intended receiver.
Sanders trying to get to the outside. Still on his feet. Goes down at the 45, barely tripped up. A 30-yard return after a 50-yard kick. Sanders has been trying to get the corner all day long. That time he turned it.
Well, this is one of the freshmen that they have been so excited about since camp. Sanders, a guy who broke long run after long run during fall camp, and Brian Kelly said, we're just looking forward to this guy catching some more punts. He's a very dangerous return man. It's amazing how much longer guys will hold blocks in punt return when there's a guy like number nine back there.
Sure.
He almost sprung it.
A lot of big plays in this game. You'd really expect more scoring. It's 19 to 14. Irish start in Virginia territory. Zaire with time. Got it to Chris Brown. He looked like he aimed that more than threw it.
He does that. And studying him, he will take some off of the ball as he goes to throw it. Let's watch his footwork. He's been working so hard on that. Good step. He does. He takes a little bit off that ball. It's something, it's rare to watch a young quarterback. Remember, he's a junior, but this is really the third ball game he's played played a bunch against USC at the end of the year, started the bowl game, started against Texas, and that's it.
Quarterback draw, and he is a very capable runner. Takes it to the 24. He's 222 pounds and has not been shy about getting contact, but
that's not good. You get down to a bunch of quarterbacks who have not played much. Remember,
redshirt freshman Deshaun Kaiser is his backup. He has thrown one pass, one, rushed twice. He threw one today, however. That was on the fake field goal. It went for a touchdown, a little shovel.
Oh, that right ankle just gets completely rolled under Kelvin Rainey. That did not look pretty. It's the right angle as Kelvin Rainey right there.
Oh, bummer. Oh, jeez.
Let's hope he's okay. I hope that that's a sprain, but that did not look good for Malik Zaire. And, of course, with the transfer of Everett Golson, now you go down to second, first-year player Deshaun Kaiser.
Malik Zaire being helped to the sideline. We are not going to replay the injury again. His ankle just folded under him. And you can only hope against hope that he's going to be all right.
And just a bummer for Irish fans and everyone, his teammates.
Procise turns the corner. Procise, touchdown. Well, if you're going with your backup quarterback, that's a good play to call.
And unfortunately for Notre Dame, as they go up in this game, a game that many people thought they would have a blowout, Procise gets really good blocking down the field, but it's just got to feel heavy right now for Notre Dame fans with what just happened to Malik Zaire.
14 carries, 138 yards for Procise, 24 on that run. So now at least the Irish will be able to nurse a lead if they have to with their backup quarterback as they're up 26-14. But Deshaun Kaiser, he's the guy now.
And Zaire looks obviously very upset. What an awful, awful injury.
Playoff contenders match it up tonight. The first top 10 matchup of the season. Saturday Night Football presented by Wells Fargo. Number 7, Oregon at East Lansing to take on number 5, Michigan State. Tonight at 8 Eastern on ABC as well as streaming live on Watch ESPN. That game was at Oregon a year ago when the Ducks prevailed.
There's Deshaun Kaiser, who now looks to take over as the quarterback. We'll wait till we hear about Malik Zaire, but it was a bad-looking right ankle injury. He looks dejected and very upset, of course, on the sidelines. That means true freshman Brandon Wimbush, someone they were hoping to redshirt, may have to start getting into the mix as a big arm, was a high recruit out of New Jersey. But with the offseason transfer of Everett Golson to Florida State, this new trend of graduate transfers going somewhere to play somewhere else. Notre Dame all of a sudden down to what would have been their third and fourth string quarterbacks coming into the season.
Exactly. Mizell a yard deep in the end zone. He'll take a knee. Last three Virginia possessions have been three and out. So let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary.
Well, right when Notre Dame needed a little spark, first play when they get the ball back, they hit Will Fuller, who could give you a heck of a spark with that speed. Zaire hit it right on the button, but then Zaire goes out with the ankle injury, so backup Kaiser hands off to the newfound running back in C.J. Procise. But the early start for Notre Dame on the injury front, they'd already lost Jerron Jones, one of their best defensive tackles. They lost Avery Sebastian, a defensive back who may be back. They lost Sean Crawford, a terrific nickelback, true freshman with a knee injury. Lost their running back last week, and now maybe their quarterback.
Johns throws the post over the middle. Severn makes the catch. We'll check in on the injury update with Dr. Jerry Bunch.
Notre Dame head trainer Rob Hunt has evaluated Malik Zaire, and so is Dr. Brian Radigan, who is the team orthopedic surgeon and basically played, by the way, played here at Notre Dame. They have asked for help from the local Virginia folks to see about an x-ray. So they're bringing a cart over, and they will load Malik Zaire into the cart to get him out to x-ray. Just so much you can do on the sideline trying to evaluate an ankle injury. You got to get some pictures to see what's wrong.
Zaccheaus for Virginia. Jerry, thank you so much for that update. And it's never good news when they bring out the cart.
I am not sure, and this is just awful news for Malik Zaire and all the work that he's put in. But I wouldn't be surprised when a guy like this, he has such a presence about him, he is such a leader, and everyone knows that really the hopes of them going to the playoffs may be getting on a cart. And I'm not sure that the defense is now not feeling that. They're playing a game Virginia offense, but this doesn't look like this Notre Dame defense looks like they're being impacted by this injury as well now.
That is the end of a dramatic third quarter. 26-14 Notre Dame. This presentation of college football will continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Malik Zaire being carted off. And I want to ask Jerry Punch after this play. I've got a question for you, Doctor. Double reverse, Mizell. Virginia trying to trick him again, and not this time. Let me ask Jerry Punch, can we read anything into the fact, Doc, that they don't have an air cast on that leg or on his ankle?
Well, normally, Mike, you cannot. But typically, if there's a fracture and you feel and the leg is unstable, they would put in an air cast. But because from watching Dr. Radigan examine the ankle and then putting Malik in the cart, you're hoping that they're thinking maybe it's the small non-weight-bearing bone, if any, that could be broken, which would be good news for Notre Dame.
Boy, you bet it would. Virginia from the 20. Reed and Mizell, double backs in this set. Toward the end zone, knocked away at the last moment, intended for Johnson. Cole Luke played it perfectly, turned around and swatted it.
And if you're Virginia, you're down 12. You just don't, the field goal's not going to, I don't think it's going to do anything for you here. I know that there's a backup quarterback about to come in. That's just excellent coverage. A little early by Luke, but they're not going to call that. He's allowed to stop. That's not a bunch of contact. It's not too early. He didn't knock through it. That's good contact. But I think third and nine, I've got to get something that's 6-7 yards, and I'd want a short fourth down. I think this is territory where you've got to think touchdown, not field goal, if you're Virginia down down eight. Excuse me.
If you go for the field goal, 12. You'd still be down two scores. Floated to Severin. He caught it inside the five. That time, Luke, who was right there, could not touch it.
Severin's helmet started to come off. It did not come off during the play, so they won't make him come out for a play. He took it off. But it looked like the helmet may have come down. What a good, nice catch by Severin. Yeah, the helmet was grabbed and then pulled off a little bit by Cole Luke. Let's hope Severin's okay.
Oh, he did get the face mask.
Yeah, and you could see the buckle off for Severin, so the helmet moved around. Not a penalty. I don't think that was a face mask call, but what a excellent play by Severin and a big third down conversion for Virginia.
117 receiving yards for Severin. Johns, nice fake. Going to try to run it in. Touchdown, Virginia. Holy cow, what a play. He doesn't run much, and he's not the fastest kid out there, but he got the job done there.
Right at the last moment, watch Sheldon Day coming from his defensive tackle position. Ooh, nearly got there. What a momentum change. The entire building changed. The Notre Dame side just fell flat when Malik Zaire went down with that ankle injury, now carted off the field. Virginia's offense came and marched right down the field on what looks like a stunned Notre Dame defense.
All three Virginia touchdown drives, 75 yards.
Who's in?
Who's in?
Who's in?
Who's in?
I'm in.
I'm in.
I'm in.
I'm in.
I'm in.
We said it earlier, after 1 week, it's tough to draw a lot of conclusions, but you would think that Notre Dame was in after the magnificent performance they put on against Texas. Now, with this game hanging in the balance, heck, this could be an elimination game, couldn't it?
Yeah, especially now that Malik Zaire is out of this game and possibly more with a right ankle injury because of the transfer of Everett Golson after spring ball to Florida State this summer.
Now for today's Aflac trivia question. When was the last season Notre Dame did not play a Big Ten team?
Well, they're not playing one this year. Of course, they have a 12-year arrangement with the ACC to play an average of 5 games a year against the ACC. So
there is a report that they're in looking into resuming the series with Michigan, which I think would be great for college football.
And I think it's a good move for Notre Dame to align with the ACC. They've, of course, aligned with them in their other sports. They are not a
yes.
full member in football. But
they'll play an average of 5 games yeah. for the next 16 years. So they're pretty close. A lot of Irish fans here, but the Virginia crowd cheering for this defense right now against the new quarterback, DeShone Kizer, who's going to come out and throw a pass on first down. It's incomplete. Chris Brown had a shot at the low throw.
I love the call by Brian Kelly. His new quarterback coach, Mike Sanford, who took over for Matt LaFleur, who took off for the Atlanta Falcons. They call a little hitch, and that ball just thrown right into dirt. Young quarterback. He's got a lot of nerves right now. I like the call, though. A good, easy throw.
Just trying to get him going.
Just get something going.
Procise. Enormous hole up the middle. Boy, is he good.
It's really hard to believe the depth that Notre Dame has to have had to go through what they've gone through at the running back position. Of course, they lost Torian Folston, their best runner, last week against Texas. They'd already had Greg Bryant, who was in the mix coming out of spring to an academic suspension and then a transfer. And now down to their third-string quarterback.
Procise flanker screen. Won't get much out of that. His last carry was 17 yards, which gives him 153 on the day.
But when we were talking to Brian Kelly, he said this is the most depth and the most athletic team that we've had since we've been here. Of course, they were in the national championship game in 2012 against Alabama, got pushed around. They've gotten better on the offensive and defensive fronts, and now a rash of injuries and a transfer, and all of a sudden their skill positions are looking like a bunch of young guys.
DeShone Kizer, redshirt freshman, 6'4 and a half. Got the big arm. Goes to Fuller, and Fuller diving for the sticks. Be a little bit short. Kizer out of Toledo, Ohio.
Brian Kelly said he's a young man who's done everything he can do in non-competitive situations. He knows the offense. He does a nice job picking up the low snap by Nick Martin.
Did not get a great spot on that last placement. Half a football short of a first down. Now the answer for our Aflac trivia question, which was, when was the last season Notre Dame did not play a Big Ten team? 1916. Woodrow Wilson was president of the United States. We were not yet in World War I.
Times, they are a-changing.
So that's 100 years yep. next year.
Well, for Notre Dame, though, with this ACC schedule, gets them to southern towns where the population is moving, starting to go south. A lot yep. of the places that they're recruiting down in the southern parts of the states.
Now, the official is making an announcement. And they're going to look at the spot. I think this is a really good challenge. Our first and 10 line is not official, but our guys are so good that it is virtually unbeatable. And it looked like Fuller put the ball on the first and 10 line. Question would be, was his knee down?
No, oh, he was actually down 2 yards.
They're going to lose.
They're going to lose
a
yard.
They're going to lose yardage on that.
Yeah.
Now, we were right. He did get the ball to the first and 10 line. But his knee was down at midfield.
So it is reviewable, forward progress for a possible first down or touchdown. So this is being reviewed. It was hit by the booth. This was not a challenge by Brian Kelly.
Good job
using
by the
booth. Timeout. Now the question is, will they back it up a yard or leave it where it was stopped, where it was spotted before? And this is reviewable. They want to make sure they get the spot right.
After review, the ball should be placed at the 49-and-a-half-yard line, third down.
So good job by the guys in the replay booth.
This is one where you make Virginia feel like you're all the world, you're going to run it between the tackles, and you sneak somebody out. Young quarterback, let him have an easy throw maybe. You're not liking it, you're thinking go for the first.
Boy,
you don't want to give it back.
I'd hesitate not to hand it to Procise.
Yeah,
He's been so good.
Well, but you're in shotgun. It's hard to run that downhill running play from the shotgun.
Yeah.
If you're going to do that, a little easier from under center.
Read option, and he didn't get it. I guess they don't have a future as a play caller, huh?
Virginia has had a wonderful game, and you just haven't. Remember that fourth down right in between the tackles. I would just want this away from the middle of the line of scrimmage. Just an excellent job. That's the second time Miles Redmond, number 56, has gotten into the backfield. He did it as well on the fourth down. Just an incredibly conservative call. I get it by Notre Dame, but that feels like one where Virginia's going to sell out to stop the run, get on the edge, or even try a throw.
Canada waits for the punt at his 10. He'll let it go.
You know,
it makes the end zone.
And you're there at fourth and one at past the 50. Again, if you have your quarterback in Malik Zaire, I think you're probably going for it. Without him, yeah, you're punting.
ESPN's College Football on ABC. Brought to you by Pacific Life. For life insurance, annuities, and investments, choose Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed. Dr. Pepper. Dr. Pepper and college football, it's a one-of-a-kind tradition. And BMW. We only make one thing, the ultimate driving machine.
It has been a decade since Virginia knocked off a top 10 team. They beat Florida State in 2005. Mizell, a lot of rope. Smoke Mizell to the 45. As the game has worn on, Virginia seems to get tougher.
They've wanted to have some type of run game going. They wanted a power run game coming into the season. They've got a little bit of that going. Mizell, a guy who was highly recruited. Big recruit out of the Tidewater area. When they got him, everybody expected big things, and here he comes in to his junior year. They're using him a bunch of different ways. He's great out of the backfield. That's a fly sweep, and Brian Kelly's troops are on their heels after their quarterback was injured two series ago.
16 carries, 55 yards for Mizell, who averaged less than 3 yards a carry against UCLA. Reed on the screen had a block downfield. Gets to the Notre Dame 45-yard line. Nice play calling here by Steve Fairchild.
Everything off to the side because there is no, they don't have a bunch of vertical stretch receivers. You mentioned T.J. Thorpe, the transfer from North Carolina, is out with a broken collarbone, a guy that they felt they could get vertical. But working the screens, working the jet sweep, there's Fairchild there, the former head coach at Colorado State. This has been a really nice play game. His offensive front has played really well, given what Texas had and couldn't block Notre Dame. His front's really showed up.
Play action fake. Johns with time. Severn open, and he missed him. Severn had two steps on Luke. The pass just wide.
And Fairchild called it beautifully. Just saying that they're not taking shots down the field. They move Severn over into the slot, He runs a beautiful corner route. He is wide open. He spun around Cole Luke, and Matt Juntz just missed him. Terrific call by Fairchild. Terrific route. You want that one back. Ball got a little flat. You want to get a little more air under that and drop it in so the guy can adjust.
He's Matt Juntz's roommate, so they'll be yakking at each other about that one tonight. Mizell cuts it back, takes it up the middle for seven.
Mizell's an impressive-looking guy. Last week against UCLA, he had eight catches for over 100 yards, or for exactly 100 yards. Terrific balance. This time, that play is stretching all the way. He sees the cutback and does a nice job getting it back to the soft side. Here you are, third and three for Virginia, down five. You've got to think you're going for potentially going for it on fourth down. So you could try a run here if you wanted.
Blitz coming. Johns doesn't see it. Ball's loose. Notre Dame recovers. Kavari Russell from the blind side on a blitz, and Matt Johns never knew he was there.
We were just talking about the nice call by Steve Fairchild. This is Brian Van Gorder, former NFL defensive coordinator, now here at Notre Dame. This, he has his best defensive lineman, Sheldon Day. Watch Day. Day backs out, and they bring the blitz from that side. Russell, Johns just didn't see him coming. Before the snap, Johns needs to recognize that there is somebody creeping from that side. It was Russell. Excellent job. Nobody there to pick him up. Mizell got up to the inside. The running back could not get back to the outside. What a huge turnover force by Kavari Russell.
Time becoming a factor. 9:31 to go. Deshaun Kizer, the backup to the injured Malik Zaire. Pump fake. Comes back to this side and throws it out of bounds. Cassidy Hubberth, an update in the studio. Cassidy. What a strange day, Cassidy. Procise can't get back to the line of scrimmage. And for one of the few times today, Virginia man-on-man was tougher.
This has got to be so disappointing for Notre Dame. They lose their quarterback, and they throw it on first down with Deshaun Kizer. I was a little surprised that they called a drop-back pass on first down the way Procise has been running. And now they get predictable. And this is a guy, corny, who can come off the edge. We've already shown you how strong and powerful he is.
Kizer with time. Now he's flushed. Had a shot at him. Now they've got him back at the 46-yard line. The pressure relentless by Virginia. Michael Kizer, the middle linebacker, coming on a blitz. Number 53 was in on the stop, and another tremendous stand by the Virginia defense.
Tough spot for Kizer to come in. Good prep, but this is about coverage. The coverage was there, and guys didn't quit. Quante Moore, a former linebacker, doesn't quit coming around, but what inspired play. The momentum has shifted. If you're just tuning in, Malik Zaire, the starting quarterback for the Irish, out with an ankle injury, and since then, Virginia's had the momentum.
And it just barely made the end zone. We've got a timeout, 8:05 to go in the ballgame.
One of many quarterbacks ascending to the first job and the backup transferring. Virginia quarterback Matt Johns, of course, Grayson Lambert now gone to Georgia, but Johns has played well enough to keep Virginia in this. Good throw to Butts, good throw to Johnson, and then I promise you, he'll get there. He's going to get there for the touchdown right before Sheldon Day knocks him sideways. And all of a sudden, Matt Johns with a really nice afternoon. The offensive line for Virginia, down two starters coming out of camp, has played really well, and a shocker in the works here in Charlottesville.
You get the feeling that this is the drive. Might be do or die for these guys. They try to hit the tight end, Charlie Hopkins, who has one catch today. And Joe Schmidt knocked it away. Schmidt is one of the great stories in Notre Dame football. He was a walk-on. He has ascended to team captain. He was voted the most valuable player on defense last year, even though he missed the last five games. That's how much they thought of Joe Schmidt.
Yeah. And when he was 5 years old, he wrote his goals out. He wanted to go to park with dad, check. Go to Baskin-Robbins. That's a good one for a five-year-old. And play football at Notre Dame. So 3 for 3, pretty good deal for a five-year-old on his goal sheet.
Should put Baskin-Robbins on there more than once. Post is complete. Nice throw to Zacchaeus. Alamide Zacchaeus gets him another first down out at the 35.
Hard to believe this is the same defense that just obliterated Texas last week. Not that they're giving up big plays, but they've just been nickel and dime the whole way. That's what Virginia has offensively. They don't have the receivers like Fuller that Notre Dame has to run by you, so they've found a way to move it around. And now another.
Illegal substitution on the offense, breaking the huddle with 12. 5-yard penalty, first down.
8 penalties against Virginia today.
And I think that is 5 of them non-compete, meaning not during the play. And this has been a knock on Mike London and his staff, is these errors. All of a sudden you get some momentum and they send in Ryan Santoro, who moved up with the injury to Andre Lavroni. But they had 12 on the field.
First and 15, Mizell, jet sweep. Cuts it back, gets 3 of the 15. Back, let's check in with Jerry Punch. Doc?
Yeah, let me update. There is X-ray facilities in Scott Stadium, so did not have to take Malik Zaire out of the stadium. They were able to take him in here to be X-rayed. We do not have a report on the X-rays as of yet, but his mom and her husband have been summoned, and they have gone to the locker room to meet Malik. So we'll update as soon as we can.
Thank you, Jerry. We really appreciate it. And our hearts certainly go out to that family. We hope he's okay. Johns with the fake. He's blitzed. Throw sideline. Severn again. 8 catches for Severn. And at least half of those have been balls that were just tossed up there. He knew where he was going. He had to get rid of it, and it was perfectly done.
Awesome job by Johns. He saw the blitz coming. He threw that way early, but he put air under it. He knew it was way early. Severn open, working one-on-one against Devin Butler. This is just a nightmare for Notre Dame fans to see Matt Johns playing this well late in the game with their quarterback in the locker room, parents coming to see him.
Little swing to Reed. No, not this time. They really diagnosed it. Jalen Smith led the charge. And they have the clock just ticking away. Nothing is stopping in under 6 minutes. You get the feeling if Virginia's going to pull the upset, they need to do it now.
I was surprised on the last drive when they let when Brian Kelly called a pass play on that very first play. I thought it was going to be all ProSize trying to run the clock out. Of course, they go 3 and out, punt it, now Virginia back on. But I agree, Mike, this feels like the last one. And you're already out almost to midfield, so I think you're right. Go for it. You got 4 downs every time.
Johns to Severn again, his 9th catch. They'll still need 6-7 yards for a first down.
But I think because I think if you're thinking we've got to go for it on fourth, you don't have to get everything here.
True.
What's the type of play that you can run where if you're going to get 3 or 4, you know, this is something you could run a draw. The quarterback can take off here. I think you're right, Mike. I think Virginia has to. This is it. So you're thinking 4 downs.
Huge day for Kanan Severn. Three-man rush underneath. They'll get half of it. This will be about 3 yards to go. I don't know that you have a choice here.
Yeah, you got to go for it. And Johnson, the guy who just caught the slant. And I don't mind the call on the slant, right? You get to pick up 5-6 yards. You're definitely going for it on fourth. But here is where, if I'm Notre Dame, I know where number 9, Kanan Severn, is. Kenan Severin for Virginia. He's been the guy. He's up to the top left. And Mizell, Mizell in the slot. Here's a guy they look to a lot.
Blitz coming. They pick it up, the pass underneath, and this is right on the sticks. The way he fell forward, it may be a first down. The yellow line says it is. And it is.
Severin, the senior that Steve Fairchild, the offensive coordinator, said, excellent route. Just an excellent route. And that's Evan Butts, the tight end, crossing. He's
nice
got to be careful. Yeah, he's got to be careful.
They
very lucky.
That.
Yeah, he wasn't running a route there. So Butts very lucky that he was not called for that. He clearly was not running a route. But a good call by Steve Fairchild. You put Mizell on one side. You've got to watch him, and Severin comes all the way back across. Big fourth down.
Field goal does them no good. They get a touchdown. They can win. Zacchaeus will stop the clock as he gets out of bounds. Picked up about 9. Just methodically chopping up the field 4 and 5 yards at a time. That time, 9.
And these are the types of drives where an inside run could pop through the middle for 10 or 15 yards. Now that this defensive line, as well as they have played, Sheldon Day has played well at times today, but as well as they played against Texas, and now this is a whole different challenge for them. They are starting to get worn out on defense, are the Irish.
How about Matt Johns? What a performance for that young man today. Staring at the number 6 defense in the entire country, a defense that just throttled Texas. Doc, you have more on Matt Johns?
Yeah, Mike. Kenan Severin says, Matt, the whole program trusts him. They believe in him. Said he exudes a calm confidence in the huddle and relaxes everyone. Said his demeanor is what helps them when the game is on the line, when they do scrimmages. We'll see if it'll help them now.
Well, he's certainly been great under pressure today, Jerry. He has been unshakable. Four-man rush. Johns wide of Reed.
You know, with Doc Putch talking about his calmness, Matt Johns went in head-to-head with Grayson Lambert into spring ball. And when we met with Matt yesterday, he said, I just had a mindset I was not going to lose the job, and he won it. And a lot of people around the program thought Lambert might have a little more talent, but I give Steve Fairchild a lot of credit, the offensive coordinator, quarterback coach. They hung it on this guy. They said, you're our guy. You'll go into summer number one. Of course, Lambert leaves in a transfer, but this guy's showing he's got a little moxie.
Blitz coming. Goes for all of it. Mizell dropped it. Are you kidding?
Matt Johns is about to get a faceful of Jalen Smith. He launches this, and Mizell just had 2 tries at it. And this is, he's not a pure receiver. He's got very good hands. That would have been an incredible catch. But now you're at 3rd and 10 instead of a touchdown. So you got to come back and regroup. Excellent job by Matt Johns.
What a remarkable throw. I mean, he knew he was going to get it right in the chops and laid it up there beautifully. Holy cow. Can he keep the drive going? Pump fake. The screen was covered. Now he tries to go downfield. Got it to Reed.
Yeah, they're going to get illegal man downfield, number 65, Ross Burbank, because they were trying to set up the screen. This is going to be a big penalty against Virginia. They were trying to set up a screen.
Ineligible receiver downfield, number 65.
And as a lineman, what's your procedure? You go out and count to what before you turn up?
Well, the problem is it's a screen pass, and so you expect it to be thrown behind
exactly.
The line of scrimmage. So Burbank, he doesn't have to think, I can't be downfield. Here's your right guard, Burbank. But it's so well defended. Excellent job that time by Isaac Rochelle, who read the screen. But Burbank, he doesn't know that the ball's not
right.
Going to be thrown down the field. So not really a mental error, just a good defensive play by Rochelle, and what a huge penalty going from what would have been.
If they decline it, it's fourth down. So instead of taking the 5 yards and giving them 2 downs, you force them to go fourth and three.
No, they accepted the penalty because it would have been fourth and about 6, I believe.
That's right. They moved it down to 13.
Yeah, so I think 3rd and 15 is the better call here for Notre Dame.
It doesn't look like it now. A perfect strike to Ryan Santoro, a 6'2", 245-pound sophomore, making his first catch of the year. What a time to get it.
Excellent throw by Johns again. Dropped it right between the corner and the safety. And this is just a magical, magical game for Virginia and Matt Johns.
Oh, they've had
great Septembers here at home in the last 3 years. They knocked off Penn State in 2012. They knocked off BYU here in 2013. And Louisville, the 21st team in the country last year. Now another big win in September at home.
Reed to the goal line. The officials come in. Touchdown! Holy cow! And now they will go for 2.
Excellent push by the Notre Dame defensive line, but they're just not able to slow down the inside runner, Albert Reed. They had bodies in the backfield, and now because Virginia goes up 1, they're going to go for 2. This is a huge play for Notre Dame. Difference being a field goal wins it or a field goal ties it when you get the ball back.
Let's go back to the first quarter. The first 3 times Notre Dame had the ball, they just walked downfield. I mean walk. Yep. They ran over Virginia. It was as easy as you could possibly be, and then it disappeared.
Disappeared. And they had 1 4th and 1 where they decided to kick it instead of going for it down inside the 15.
And now their starting quarterback, Malik Zaire, is in the training room with wraps on his ankle.
And Deshaun Kizer, second year at Notre Dame, did not play last year.
Call on the field here was a touchdown, so I don't know. Way you can reverse that.
Ball's over the goal line. Let's see on this side if the knee is down before it goes down.
There's such a pile of bodies in there, you don't know if the knee's on another player.
After review, they let it stand.
Usually if we can't see it, they can't see it either. And now they will go for 2. So that a field goal would only tie them.
How about the big throw to Ryan Santoro, a guy who first catch of the year. Mike London wanting a timeout. I mean, I know you want to talk this over. I worry about that timeout being burnt right now. You're at the 2, under 2 minutes. If Notre Dame goes down and is able to score, it's a little nitpicky. You want to save as many of those timeouts. I know you want to get this play right, but you're in a tight game here.
I'd rather get this play right, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I agree. I'm just thinking of 2 possessions ahead,
sure,
what you'd want if Notre Dame were able to score. But how about the big play? Ryan Santoro comes in. They've had injuries at receiver. T.J. Thorpe from North Carolina, who transferred in, expected him to play. Donnie Dowling is out today. We learned yesterday Andre Lebroni was out with a back injury, and here comes Santoro with the big 3rd and 15 catch.
Let's take a look at this week's AP rankings brought to you by Capital One. Notre Dame had moved up to 9th from 11th after the pounding they delivered to Texas. Top 3 with big leads. Auburn just survived.
You know, and Mike London, one of the guys coming into the season on the one of the hotter seats in the coaching profession. What do you think this would do for that chair?
He was on the top of everybody's list, that's for sure. Mizell goes in motion. Johns could run. It was wide open. He throws for the end zone, incomplete, intended for Butts.
That's a really important play for Notre Dame. They have not been good in the kicking game. They had three missed field goals by their freshman, Justin Yoon, but a field goal to win it instead of a touchdown is a big deal.
Now all you have to do is come back with your backup quarterback. The NFL is back, and in 2 days we've got two games for you. The Eagles and the Falcons, and then the Vikings against the 49ers. Monday Night Countdown starts at 5 Eastern. The story here, we have less than 2 minutes to go. Notre Dame down by one. They'll get the ball on the kickoff. Amir Carlisle is deep. High and short, Carlisle from the 5. Cuts it outside, but they've got him shy of the 20-yard line. It was 20 years ago when number 2 Florida State came to Charlottesville. Tiki Barber, the great running back, went for 193 yards, including a 64-yard touchdown run. And then with 5 seconds to go in the game, down by 5, Warrick Dunn took a direct snap, weaved his way to the goal line, but lost the ball as he was being tackled. Time expired. 33-28 Virginia over FSU. Cavaliers fans hoping the magic continues from 20 years ago. Kaiser. Nice toss to Fuller. Tackled inbounds at the 28-yard line.
With 3 timeouts for Notre Dame, you've got a ton of time. The clock stops in college football for first downs and out of bounds now that we're inside 2. But you don't want to waste a lot of time on plays like that. Use those timeouts. If you run the ball, make sure you're using the timeout.
That ball bangs off of the hands of Fuller. This kid's got a gun. There's no doubt about that.
But think about the adrenaline for Kaiser. Didn't play at all. Barely played against Texas. Comes in right when Malik Zaire gets hurt. Now the crowd into it. His first real college game, and he's got to run a 2-minute drill down one on the road. Welcome to college football, Deshaun.
Most backup quarterbacks don't get a lot of reps. The starter needs almost all of them. Four-man rush, throws the out, knocked away. Almost picked by Maurice Kennedy. He saw that coming 3 seconds before they threw it.
I think this is C.J. Prosise time for Notre Dame. You got to pick up the first down. And Virginia is just zoning in on this guy. What a great job by Kennedy. He walks in if he's half a step earlier. But now I think Notre Dame calling a timeout, wanting to talk through this important fourth down. But I think this has got to be Prosise in some type of movement, maybe a jet sweep or something. But Prosise has been the difference, been able to pick it up. I'm not sure that I want my young guy throwing this ball.
Notre Dame is 0 for 10 on fourth down. 0 for or third down. They are 1 for 2 on fourth down. There's no way we could have expected this game after the first quarter. No way.
It's amazing when we were studying coming into this game. You look at the tape and look at the point spread. There was about a 2-touchdown favorite. That felt even maybe a little
low,
out of whack after what we saw. But the momentum for Virginia, they have played well at home in September. That's the one thing you can hang your hat on for Virginia. This would be their 4th big win at home during the Mike London era in September. And what a shocker this would be. Notre Dame against Texas looked unbeatable. And I think Texas is pretty shaky, but they looked unbeatable. Not so much today.
Fourth and a long 2 for Kaiser.
I'm shocked if this is a throw.
Quarterback draw. And Kaiser, a powerful runner at 6'4 and a half, 230, gets it. Stops the clock till they move the chains.
Let's see what happens once they start that clock, though. Now, because they've used one timeout, now the clock's starting to become a bit of an enemy.
Beautiful pass over the middle on the slant. Catch made by Corey Robinson, the Admiral's son. Big target. 6'4.5", 215. Notre Dame with a freshman field goal kicker. I'm not sure why the official stopped the clock.
There's Justin Yoon, true freshman. Hopefully you're telling him a joke, getting him to relax some. That's Kavari Russell over there. I know we haven't known each other for long, Justin, but I'd really like you to make this kick if you get a chance. Just saying. We got a long way to go.
Pressure. Kaiser gets away from it, throws it back over the middle in a wide open Procise. 17 on the little check down.
I like that timeout by Brian Kelly there because of so many people moving around. Because the play broke apart, so all the linemen were spread around. I think he saw we're not going to get a play in under about 10 or 15 seconds. I don't want to burn that. You have more control with a play call, so I like that timeout there by Kelly. That could have burnt 15 to 20 very important seconds. Excellent job. Procise, of course, switched from running back from receiver during the spring, so has a good feel when the quarterback is scrambling around. Terrific job by number 20.
If you assume that Yoon would have a legitimate shot from, say, 52 yards, now you've got to get to the 35.
They think they're comfortable at under the 35. They want him at 33, but remember, this is a young man, true freshman. He's already missed three kicks in the first two ball games. So there are no gimmies here for Justin Yoon, a highly recruited young man. Notre Dame had a punter kicker last year who graduated, who was very solid for them. And I would think 25-yard line would be about where Notre Dame is going to start feeling a little more comfortable about this young man coming out to kick.
Notre Dame has only one timeout left. You would like to save that to get the field goal unit off. Little screen, Procise breaks the tackle, only gets to the 39.
Watch that clock. Because of the screen, taking a while to get back. There was 37 seconds left when that play ended. Watch
and
how long
Smythe
this takes.
Smythe is hurt, limping off the field, so they've got to get a man on for him.
Oh, boy, this is really tough clock management here. It's almost 20 seconds gone.
Toward the end zone! Touchdown! Will Fuller! 39 yards! What a throw by Kaiser! He bought time and then threw a strike! Holy cow!
And Virginia had coverage over there, and they took their eyes off of Fuller when Kaiser started moving to the side. There was a safety and a corner. Canaday got beat. The safety took his eyes off. 1 foot in bounds is all you need in the college game.
Fuller is a star, and Kaiser found him.
Excellent job by Fuller, never giving up on the play, though. He continued to sneak behind Canaday. Kaiser, as he rolled out, came back. And Mike,
How's that for your first touchdown pass? Only 12 seconds left to come back and stop the upset.
And because of that screen, that clock went from 27. Oh. They lost almost, 37 to almost 17 seconds. They lost almost 20 seconds before that snap. So if you don't hit that one, you're scrambling for your next play.
Really courting disaster.
If it's incomplete, the clock stops. But what a difference it would have made for Virginia. And what a shocker. All the momentum in the world when Malik Zaire went down in the third quarter. If you missed it, Malik Zaire went down with a right ankle injury. It was gruesome looking. We don't have a report yet, but Deshaun Kaiser came in, who'd played just a touch against Texas, had not played in this game. And, well, you know who to go to if you're the quarterback at Notre Dame now, right?
Oh. Before that drive, he was only 1 for 3. 4 for 4 on that drive. Also had a 4-yard scramble.
And now up
or started
five.
On that drive, 1 for 3.
And now
me.
Up 5. You go for 2 to make it 7.
This place is stunned. And can you blame them? To the end zone for two. Wide open, Torrey Hunter Jr.
You know,
if you're a Virginia defensive player, I don't even know how you line up after that.
And you know the bummer for Virginia, and of course Mike London on the hot seat last year, they came out, Craig Littlepage, the athletic director, and said he is coming back for 2015, but most people thinking it's got to be a bowl game or better. They started out with two of the best defensive teams in the country athletically in UCLA and Notre Dame. And the bummer for them is now they get William & Mary, but then they have to play number 20, Boise State. So in the first month, they play three teams in the top 20.
Yeah, good luck with that.
Just an impossibly tough schedule. This team is much better than what we saw a couple of years ago when we were here.
Certainly.
Better at every position, deeper. And the bummer for Mike Lennon and his staff is they're going to be sitting here at 0-2. Yeah, they get William & Mary, but can they keep it together? Because this team, I think, is good enough to win 6, 7, 8 games, go to a bowl game. But with this September, what a tough start to a really important season for Mike London and his future.
This game psychologically, unless they can score in the last 12 seconds, is we had them.
It's got to hurt.
And you can't, there are no moral victories anymore. Not at this level. And you can say, what can you say? We had them, we let them go.
You hope that your leadership, you hope that guys like Matt Johns and Dean, the defensive tackle, you hope that they can get guys going. You get a little easier game against William & Mary next week, but for Notre Dame, that's what you got to think if you're Notre Dame. And then you got to regroup. You're down to your third string quarterback, what you thought coming out of spring ball with Everett Golson transferring and Malik Zaire going down with what looked like a bad ankle injury in this game.
Wasn't that an odd play to you that Mizell would take a knee? Your most dangerous runner. You got 12 seconds. Give the kid a shot.
Yeah, but with 10, you get two, maybe three plays. Try to get one to midfield. And
three 5-yarders.
Did you happen to watch BYU-Nebraska last week?
Yes, yes.
I think you'd want to be a little closer. I think it was just feeling like it was a waste of time, maybe.
Notre Dame has a safety 50 yards from the line of scrimmage. So they'll throw it underneath, almost intercepted. And incomplete with 4 seconds left.
Well, now if you had YouTube, you'd bring up the Cal Stanford play with the kick where the ball was thrown back and forth about 15 times. Yeah, that's about all you have now for Virginia. No way Matt Johnson's gonna be able to get this down the field far enough for a touchdown. So you just pitch it around for a while and see if you can't score. But you have to think Irish fans are at home and they don't really care about this win because of the injury to Malik Zaire. They have to go 12-0 to go to the college football playoff. And
here we go with the Stanford band, but it's over. Virginia just played its heart out today. There's no way around it.
You know what? Give some credit to Notre Dame for hanging in there, too.
Oh,
you
absolutely
lose your starting quarterback, not playing great. And you know, you hear that term, big players make big plays.
Yeah.
Well, I think Fuller is pretty big time.
And especially give credit to Kaiser. I mean, what a performance for that young man who doesn't expect to play. Comes off the bench. His team is down. They're being upset on the road. And he just finds a way.
Terrific experience for that young man as well.
Doc, let's go to you.
Well, Coach, take us back to 43 seconds on the clock. You got a backup quarterback and you're 50 yards away. You call the timeout. What are you thinking?
Well, you know, we had a couple of plays in mind that we felt like, you know, a couple of things for Deshaun that he had done well. Again, you know, we're playing a quarterback that we didn't expect to play today, losing, you know, Malik. And so we went to some things that we thought he could execute. He's a big, strong kid, and one of them was to push the ball down the field. So we made a play when we needed to late. Give a lot of credit to Virginia today. They played inspired football. They played really well. But we made one more play at the end. I'm proud of the way our kids played at the end.
Coach, you mentioned Malik. The Irish faithful held their breath. We saw him carted off for x-rays. What can you tell us?
Well, I don't have exactly what happened other than we know that it was an ankle injury. And I know I'll talk to our team physician when we get in there. But you know, it wasn't great news at the initial diagnosis, but we'll find more when I get into the locker room.
With him out of the lineup, how difficult does that make it for the Irish, for a football team that focused on him as a leader offensively?
Well, you know, you never want to lose in back-to-back weeks your starting running back and your starting quarterback. But, you know, that's college football, and we'll persevere. Deshaun did a great job. He led us down the field for a touchdown here, and he's going to have a lot of confidence. And if Malik can't go, Deshaun's going to be the guy that we're going to rally around.
Hey, Coach, congratulations on your win. Thanks for your time.
Thanks, Sherry. Appreciate it.
And it makes that matchup next week against Georgia Tech even that much more difficult. But off of what little we saw from Deshaun Kizer, if they want to come out and throw the ball, he's got a gun. They can play that way. But Virginia, what do you do now?
Got to regroup. They can win seven games. They can get to a bowl game.
Once again, our final score, Notre Dame 34, Virginia 27. Don't forget tonight on ABC, Oregon, Michigan State for Ed Cunningham and Dr. Jerry Punch and our entire crew. This is Mike Patrick. So long from Charlottesville, Virginia.